keeps you guessing. Like any real love, it's ever changing. Like any true love, it drives you crazy. But you know you wouldn't change anything, anything, anything. Welcome to New York. It's been waiting for you. Welcome to New York. Welcome to New York. Welcome to New York. It's been waiting for you. Welcome to New York. Welcome to New York. It's a new soundtrack. I could dance to this beat. The lights are so bright, but they never blind me. Welcome to New York. New soundtrack. It's been waiting for you. Welcome to New York. The lights are so bright, but they never blind me.
Welcome to New York.
So bright, they never blind me.
Welcome to New York.
Welcome to New York.
Yeah, I'm out at Brooklyn. Now I'm down in Tribeca, right next to the Narrow. But I'll be hood forever. I'm the new Sinatra. And since I made it here, I can make it anywhere. Yeah, they love me everywhere. I used to cop in Harlem. All of my Dominicanos right there up on Broadway. Pulled me back to that McDonald's. Took it to my...
Fast spot, 550 Bay Street. Catch me in the kitchen like...
Simmons whipping pastry, cruising down A Street, off-white Lexus, driving so slow, but BK is from Texas. Me, I'm out that Bed-Stuy, home of that boy Biggie. Now I live on Billboard, and I brought my boys with me. Say what up to Tata, still sipping my top, sitting courtside, Knicks and Nets give me high five. Nigga, I be spiked out, I could trip a referee, tell by my attitude that I most definitely from. With OG at a Yankee game. Shit, I made the Yankee hat more famous than a Yankee can. You should know I bleed blue, but I ain't a crypto. But I got a gang of niggas walking with my click though. Welcome to the melting pot. Corners where we selling rock. Africa been by the shit. Home of the hip hop. Yellow cap, gypsy cap, dollar cap, holla back. For foreigners, it ain't fair. They act like they forgot how to act. 8 million stories out there in the naked. City, it's a pity half of y'all won't make it. Me, I got a plug special and I got it made. If Jesus paying LeBron, I'm paying Dwayne Wade. Three dice CeeLo, three card Marley. Labor Day parade, rest in peace Bob Marley. Statue of Liberty, long live the World Trade. Long live the King, yo, I'm from the Empire State. That's blinding. Girls need blinders so they could step out of bounds quick. The sidelines is lined with casualties who sip the life casually, then gradually become worse. Don't fight the apple eve. Caught up in the in crowd. Now you're in style. And in the winter gets cold, in vogue with your skin out. City of sin, it's a pity on a whim. Good girls going bad, the city's filled with them. Mommy took a bus trip, now she got a bust out. Everybody ride her, just like a bus route. Hail Mary to the city, you're a virgin. And Jesus can't save you, life starts when the church in. Came here for school, graduated to the highlight. Ball players, rap stars, addicted to the limelight. Empty in May, got you feeling like a champion. The city never sleeps, better slip you an Ambien.
Street.
All right, I think we can hold the fun music. It's been great. Thanks for that, Dr. Jara Almonte. So I'm Laura Melville. I'm from NYP Brooklyn. And I would like to welcome you to the 21st All NYC Educational Conference. Welcome, New York and New Jersey. Hopefully this will be our last Zoom. We are really looking forward to seeing you all in person. So, okay, we're 21, not years, but educational conferences in. And so we're gonna talk about some adult themes in emergency medicine today. And we have a fantastic lineup. And Dr. Dara Almonte and I will be introducing you to some pretty awesome people. And I think we'll just get started then. Our first speaker today is Dr. Annie Katz. She is an assistant professor of clinical emergency medicine and the assistant program director for the New York Presbyterian Emergency Medicine Residency Program at Cornell and Columbia. Dr. Katz earned her medical degree from Albert Einstein College of Medicine and completed her residency training in emergency medicine at St. Luke's Mount Sinai West Hospital Center. She subsequently completed a fellowship in simulation at Mount Sinai St. Luke's Mount Sinai West Hospital Center. And I just want to welcome Dr. Katz, who's going to talk to us about, go ahead and share your screen. I want to let it be a, it's not a surprise since you all have the flyer. She's going to talk to us.
All right. I'm going to share my screen. All right. So good morning, New York and New Jersey. Again, I'm Annie Katz. Thank you so much for that warm introduction. So I am thrilled to be kicking off the theme of 21 and over with a talk on priapism. So let's get started. My objectives for the day is for the audience to be able to differentiate between ischemic and non-ischemic priapism, to learn how to perform all priapism related procedures. We're going to review the latest 2021 American Urologic Association guidelines, and we're going to learn the management for priapism of all ages. So you come to your shift on a Monday morning, and when it rains, it pours, you have four back-to-back cases of priapism. The first case is a 50-year-old male who has a history of erectile dysfunction, and he recently used Caverject, which is a PG-1 analog, and he's coming in with a pretty painful erection for the past 6 hours. Next up is a 25-year-old male. He endorsed a recent penile trauma while riding a bike about a week ago. And then this morning he woke up with an erection that doesn't seem to be going down, but he's not in too much pain. Then you have an 8-year-old with sickle cell disease. He has recurrent priapism and he is screaming and crying in triage and needs your help. And then last but not least, you have a 6-day-old that's brought in by mom who has a prolonged erection for the past 5 hours and is not quite sure what to do, but the baby looks pretty comfortable. Where is the word priapism derived from? It comes from the ancient Greek god Priapus, who is the god of fertility. He's the protector of livestock, fruits, gardens, and of course, male genitalia. He is classically depicted in Roman art with an oversized and permanent erection, hence the word priapism came to be. How do we define priapism? It is a prolonged erection for more than 4 hours in the absence of sexual stimuli. So what's the emergency? So I hope that nobody in their careers will ever see a case like this, which is essentially trazodone-induced priapism that resulted in penile necrosis and subsequent amputation. Although you probably won't be seeing such a severe case if the patient comes in on time, what we're trying to do is prevent the morbidity of erectile dysfunction. So the sooner you treat, the better. So here's a quick review on the anatomy of the penile shaft. So this is a cross section, and what you see here are in the white circular outline is that's the tunica albuginea that contains the corpora cavernosa, and in the center you have the cavernosal arteries. You also have ventrally located the corpus spongiosum with the urethra, and dorsally located, you can't really see here, is your neurovascular bundle with the dorsal penile nerve, artery, and vein, which is what you're going to want to avoid when you're doing your procedures. So I know this is a super complex, busy slide, but I do think it might be helpful to shed light on the physiology of an erection. We're gonna talk about just some key players here. So you got some parasympathetic stimulus and you have release of nitrous oxide. This is a penile smooth muscle cell. So essentially once you have nitrous oxide release, you're going to have increase in your cyclic GMP, You're going to have decreased intracellular calcium, and you're going to have then smooth muscle relaxation. You're going to have increased arterial inflow and then engorgement and an erection. Just a quick word on how our erectile dysfunction medications work. So up here, we have a list of our PDE5 inhibitors like Viagra. It acts by inhibiting that PDE5 enzyme that would break down cyclic GMP. So if you inhibit your PDE5, you're going to have increased levels of your cyclic GMP, decrease intracellular calcium levels, and then smooth muscle relaxation, and then engorgement and an erection. For the Cavraject or the alprostadil that the patient used when he came into the ER, he injected intracavernously this agent, which acts by increasing your cyclic AMP and then subsequently will reduce calcium stores in the muscle cell, and then you will have engorgement and erection. So how does this translate to a macro level? So you have some type of audiovisual tactile stimuli that releases that nitrous oxide. And here you can see the flaccid versus the erect state. And on the right, you can see once you have the release of nitrous oxide, you will have dilation of those sinusoids in the corpus cavernosum. When you have that engorgement, it will compress the venous plexus that is in the tunica albuginea, and then you have no outflow of blood. You also have no inflow of arterial blood when you are in erect state because the mean arterial pressure within the shaft of the penis exceeds that of the systemic mean arterial pressure. So you have no inflow of blood and no outflow of blood. And there you have an erection until you have some sympathetic stimulus that causes contraction of all those sinusoids. So this was just a pretty neat picture of what it looks like on a microscopic level for the subtunical venous plexi. So this is the flaccid state in picture C. These are nice plump venous plexus. And then once you have an engorged state, the subtunical venous plexi will compress and you'll have no blood flow going out. The epidemiology of priapism, it affects about 5 in 100,000 males per year. There is a bimodal age distribution, and it affects the 5 to 10-year-olds, and then again at 20 to 50. There are two major subtypes. The first one is low-flow priapism or ischemic priapism. That's the one we really care about in the emergency room. This affects 95% of cases. You also have high-flow or non-ischemic priapism, and there's a third type, stuttering priapism, which will be on the scope of this talk. So what's going on in ischemic priapism? So essentially, you have abnormal prolonged relaxation of the corpus cavernosum, and you have failure to contract. And after about 4 to 6 hours, this results in ischemia, hypoxia, acidosis, glucopenia, hypercarbia, and the patient has a ton of pain when this develops. They come in with a rigid state, and this is essentially compartment syndrome of the penis, and it is a urologic emergency. What are the causes for ischemic priapism? There is a laundry list here. We kind of mentioned in the physiology slide how the intracavernosal agents, the PDE5 inhibitors, work to ultimately decrease calcium stores and cause smooth muscle relaxation. So any alteration to that pathway or prolonged decreased calcium stores will lead to prolonged relaxation. Other drugs that have been implicated are antihypertensives like hydralazine, antidepressants like the trazodone, antipsychotics, anticoagulation like heparin, which works through basically a antibody that causes microthrombosis. You have also recreational drugs like cocaine. Hematological causes, I think we're all pretty familiar with sicklers coming in with priapism and treating those. And you also have thalassemia, TTP, multiple myeloma, and leukemia. Tumors can also just cause mechanical obstruction of the venous outflow, inducing priapism. And then finally, we have neurological causes, infectious, metabolic, like TPN, gout. And many times we just don't know why we see priapism. And those are the idiopathic cases. So moving on to non-ischemic priapism, this is essentially a fistula formation between the cavernosal artery and the corporal cavernosis. This is a result of just really good arterial blood flow into the shaft. So the patients are typically not in pain. They come in a semi-rigid state. It could be caused by direct trauma. Usually it's in the setting of some remote trauma. It's not in the setting of an acute trauma. So that 25-year-old male who came in, who reported some penile trauma a week ago, usually there's no significant pain, and then they wake up one morning with high flow priapism. Congenital causes can also do this, and even a shunt that's initially placed for ischemic priapism can cause fistula formation in this location. So again, this is not an emergency because you have excellent arterial blood flow into the shaft of the penis. How do we diagnose ischemic versus non-ischemic priapism? It's largely a clinical diagnosis. So the kid who's coming in with a history of sickle cell disease and he's in a lot of pain, you have a pretty good idea that it's going to be ischemic. The AUA recommends a penile blood gas for all patients coming in with first-time priapism. And when you get that blood gas, here you don't have to memorize any numbers. The non-ischemic blood gas is going to look normal with a normal pH, O2, and CO2. And the ischemic blood gas is just going to be pretty abnormal looking with a low pH and low O2. So really nothing to memorize there. You can also get an ultrasound if there's any diagnostic uncertainty. So when you get that color duplex ultrasound, pretty simple. And on the left here, you have no flow in the cavernosal artery. And on the right, you have excellent high flow in the cavernosal artery. So this is your ischemic and then non-ischemic priapism. How do we manage ischemic priapism? So here you do not want to be cheap with your opiates. You want to be pretty liberal. Get your patients parenteral dilaudid morphine before you start setting up for your definitive management. So I'm a big history buff. I find anything historical fascinating. So over 100 years ago in the Annals of Surgery in 1914, they were using leeches actually as a potential treatment option for ischemic priapism. Although it is still used in modern medicine, we do not use leeches for the treatment of priapism today. So what is new? So fortunately, the AUA just came out with their updated practice guidelines in November 2021. And the unfortunate thing is there are no high quality studies or very little looking at the different treatment options. So the recommendations are largely expert opinion and low quality evidence. But the bottom line remains that we're still going to treat with aspiration plus minus irrigation with intracavernosal phenylephrine. So before you start the mainstay of the procedure, you're going to perform a dorsal penile nerve block to ensure that the patient obtains adequate analgesia of the shaft of the penis. So the first thing you're going to do is consent the patient. You also just want to let the patient know that they still, even if you treat the priapism, they still might go on to develop erectile dysfunction. You also want to let them know that the procedure itself can cause hematoma formation, infection. Theoretically, you can cause a fistula if you go too deep while aspirating and irrigating to the cavernosal artery. So there are just a few things you want to mention. Once you consent the patient, you're going to prep the skin, you're going to drape, you are going to take a 19 gauge needle, you're going to load a 10 cc syringe with lidocaine 1%, and you're going to aim for the 2 and 10 o'clock position. So I'm going to first describe it with this picture, and then we're going to watch a video on how to perform this. So what you want to do is palpate the pubic bone before you're going to insert your needle. What you can do is you can go actually midline in where the suspensory ligament is, and you hit the pubic bone. Once you hit the pubic bone, you're going to aim either at the 2 or 10 o'clock position. You're going to slide beneath the pubic bone about 3 to 5 millimeters. You're going to aspirate, make sure you're not on any artery, and then you're going to inject the 5 cc's, and then you're going to do the procedure again on the other side. So let's see what it looks like. And this is pretty much the only video on YouTube I can find that's decent. So if you've seen it, great. And if not, here you go. Oh, okay, great. So now that you have adequately anesthetized the patient, they're comfortable. Now you're going to perform the meat of the procedure where you're going to aspirate, you're going to think about irrigation and phenylephrine injection. These guidelines come directly from the AUA's website. They do note that there is no gold standard for the procedural setup. And a lot of this is, again, expert opinion. I'm going to give you what the AUA gives as their guidelines, but note you'll see differences of practice variations. So the first thing you're going to do is put the patient on the monitor. You can get an 18-gauge butterfly needle. You're going to insert at the 3 or 9 o'clock position at the base of the penile shaft. Remember that you don't need to insert on both sides because the corpus cavernosa do communicate with each other. So you will be able to draw blood from both sides. So once you you insert, you're going to connect also to the 30 to 60 cc lure lock syringe. At this point, you're going to aspirate until you see some degree of detumescence. At this point, you can consider irrigation. You're going to inject phenylephrine. You wait 5 minutes, and then you repeat until you get complete detumescence. Remember that once you complete the procedure, you must compress where you injected, and then you're going to also wrap, put a compression bandage around the shaft. So we're going to talk more about all of these steps. So this is another setup where you have a three-way stopcock. Again, here you have your butterfly needle and one syringe is aspirating while the other has saline where you can irrigate and just alternate. I've also seen people where they do insert two butterflies, one where you're irrigating and then the other side you're gonna be aspirating, but I think that one puncture needle is probably best. Again, no gold standard for doing this procedure. So we're going to take a deep dive now into aspiration, irrigation, and phenylephrine injections. So the main question is, do we even need to aspirate? Why can't we just inject phenylephrine? And again, there are no studies directly comparing aspiration and irrigation to alpha adrenergic injections alone. What we do have is just studies looking at the combination of these three, and people achieve successful detumescence in up to 93% of the cases. And there's also less need for subsequent shunt surgery. The idea behind aspirating is that you're going to remove the deoxygenated acidic blood, and then you're going to prime those alpha receptors to the subsequent phenylephrine injection. And hopefully it will work better when they're in an oxygenated environment. People also ask, how much do I irrigate? So you don't need to drain half the body's volume. I think most people will achieve some type of detumescence, anywhere from 50 to 70 cc's. I know people go higher than that. But really, your goal is not to just keep draining. It's just to get some softness, some flaccidity, or you see some change in the color of the blood and where it becomes brighter red. But again, there's no recommendation of how much to withdraw. It's a case by case situation. So what about irrigation? Here also, absolutely no good evidence for this. I think when urologists decide to irrigate, it's usually because they feel like they're having trouble aspirating and the blood is pretty viscous, they're clots. So at this point, if you are having trouble aspirating, feel free to inject, 25 cc's of saline and break up the clots, and then you withdraw. Interestingly, this is brand new from the AUA. This is a study that was randomized, and they looked at patients who received various temperatures of saline, so ranging from 10 degrees to 37 degrees. Patients were irrigated with 25 cc's of normal saline every 20 minutes until a max of 125 milliliters were administered. So remember, you don't have to irrigate with a liter of saline into the shaft. So the patients who did receive the coldest saline at 10 degrees Celsius did experience the highest rates of resolution versus those who received room temperature saline. So the bottom line here is consider cold saline. Of course, those who have sickle cell disease, they were all excluded in this because theoretically cold temperatures can precipitate sickling. How does this change my clinical practice? Not much. I'm not going to be sitting there with a thermometer measuring the temperature of the saline. What I might do is throw some a saline syringe with and then throw it in a basin of ice and try to cool it down if I decide to irrigate. So word on phenylephrine. So interestingly, phenylephrine is not the only agent you can inject epinephrine or norepinephrine into the shaft of the penis. And I think this goes against the grain of every ED doc who is told never to inject any of these vasoconstrictive agents into any distal extremity. But remember, since you have no blood flow in and out of the shaft, you should never achieve systemic effects of these medications. But that is why we still put patients on the monitor, because it can, and you do want to monitor their blood pressure and heart rate. The AUA recommends phenylephrine as their agent of choice because it only has alpha effects and no beta effects. So what we're going to do is we can inject anywhere from 200 to 500 mics every 5 minutes. I'll use the lower end for patients who have cardiovascular risk disease, who have stents. So I might go low. And then for patients who otherwise are pretty much healthy, that have sickle cell, I might just go big, go home, start with 500 Q5 minutes. You can actually go up to 2000 mics. I know that a lot of places will say 1000 mics is your maximum, but plenty of studies have shown 2000 to be safe as long as you don't see changes in vital signs. And after about an hour, if you don't achieve any detumescence, you're going to call urology to take these patients to the OR. So just a word on how to dilute phenylephrine. I'm pretty much not going to talk about it because I think it's really dangerous to memorize. I know when I was a resident, I was diluting this. And now, fortunately, my institution has pre-made syringes that contain 500 mics per ml. When you dilute, you tend to have 1,000 mics per ml. So you have to be very careful with dosing. This is not a Neo stick. This is a ton of phenol in 1 milliliter. So again, just know what your institution has. If you don't have pre-made syringes, I would have a safe place to look up quickly in those situations. So what about Sudafed and terbutaline? I know that back in the day, I might have given this, but really the AUA came out and said, absolutely, this is not recommended for the management of ischemic priapism. So skip it, forget it. Moving on to non-ischemic priapism management. The good news, this is not urgent. Remember, you have good arterial blood flow. You can watch the sunset in these cases. You're going to observe. If the patient doesn't have, does not detumesce in the ED and they're pretty uncomfortable going home, you can consider calling urology at this point, and they might take them for embolization or even surgical ligation. What does embolization look like? So this is a picture of an arteriogram that shows contrast leak from the cavernosal artery into the corpus cavernosum. Once the patient was coiled, the fistula resolved and the patient did well. So the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about pediatric priapism and neonatal priapism. So I know when we hear the word pediatric in general, that makes us uncomfortable, but then we add priapism to that mix, makes us even more uncomfortable. We kind of feel like this child right here, but I think you're going to be okay managing these if you need to. So the majority of cases are actually a result of sickle cell disease as opposed to drugs in the adults. Followed by leukemia, trauma, idiopathic cases, and drugs can also do this if they get their hands on maybe Viagra as a child accidentally. So you also should know that if the kid does not have a history of sickle cell disease, this could be a first presentation of leukemia. So you're going to want to get a CBC, an ultrasound in the children, and a penile blood gas. What can we do immediately if the kid comes in within the first few hours? You can give them fluids, you can give them pain medicine, you ask them to urinate and exercise, you can put some cold packs if they're not sickle cell patients, but honestly, this is kind of voodoo. There's been no evidence to suggest that any of this works. So if you don't have resolution, I like this algorithm. I took this from the Journal of Pediatric of Urology. Unfortunately, the AUA doesn't have specific guidelines for pediatric patient or doses. They do say you can use phenylephrine in children, but they just say at a lower dose and don't specify how much to give. Here, this is nice because it gives you exact doses, and I'll talk about the algorithm right now. So the first thing you're going to do in children, again, you need to anesthetize them properly with a dorsal penile nerve block, or if the kid is not going to tolerate that right away, you can do conscious sedation, and ketamine is your agent of choice because it is a known detumescence agent. So once the kid is comfortable, here you're going to aspirate, consider irrigation if you're having some viscous and clotted blood. Here you're not going to be aspirating 50 cc's at once. Here you're going to do like baby aliquots of 5 milliliters until either you see some flaccidity or bright red blood. So the difference here in this algorithm is children less than 10, you're going to use epinephrine. And why do we use epinephrine in this age group? Because that is only what we have in the literature that has been shown to be safe. There are no good studies on phenylephrine in children less than 10. So you can safely use epinephrine in children less than 10. You can use either 1 to 1,000 or 1 to 10,000 concentration of epi, but you just have to dilute it down to 1 mic per milliliter. Again, I think another point here is do not memorize this. You might want to just take a picture of this, but this is not to be memorized. So what you do is once you dilute it down to 1 mic per mL, you are going to load 10 mLs, which contains 10 mics, and you're going to inject that. And then you can wait you can wait 10 minutes and you can do that up to 4 times until you see detumescence. For the children 11 and over, this is easy peasy. You're going to give phenylephrine. You give a lower dose at 100 Q5 minutes for a total of 1000 mics. So neonatal priapism, here, the really good news is that there are no cases of ischemic priapism that have been reported. There are very few case reports in literature on this. There have been cases that the erection lasts for up to 12 days. The thought is, we don't know why many of the cases occur. It's idiopathic. There is a theory that it occurs to perineal trauma during birth. So maybe a high flow state a little bit, but really unclear. The second cause is thought to be due to polycythemia. Interestingly, even if a kid is diagnosed with sickle cell disease at birth, there are no cases of ischemic priapism because of the presence of fetal hemoglobin. All these patients have full functional recovery. It causes no distress to any of these infants. You should obtain a CBC ultrasound and observe, but ultimately they should do just fine. They will detumesce and they can follow up with urology, but you can provide lots of reassurance. So you are a hero. You have successfully treated all your patients for the day. So that 50-year-old who came in with that Keverject injection, you decided to give him a dorsal penile nerve block. You aspirated, you maybe irrigated, you injected phenylephrine, and he detumesced. That 25-year-old reported a penile trauma about a week ago. He wasn't in too much pain. So you observed him. He did not detumesce in the ED. So you called urology, they took him for embolization and he was discharged subsequently and did really well. That 8-year-old with sickle cell disease, you actually started him on conscious sedation with ketamine. You aspirated 5 cc's of blood, felt maybe like irrigating, maybe not. And then you gave him some epinephrine, 10 mics and 10 mLs, and he did really well. That 6-day-old with that prolonged erection, you reassured mom, you observed. He actually detumesced in the ED, he went home and everyone was happy. So here's some key takeaways. I hope by now you feel comfortable distinguishing ischemic versus non-ischemic priapism. You know how to do that dorsal penile nerve block. You're going to do a combination therapy with aspiration plus minus irrigation, preferably some cold saline if they're not sicklers, and phenylephrine injection for your adults and epinephrine for your pediatric patients less than 10. These are my references. I want to thank my NYP family. It has been an absolute pleasure over the years. So I hope everyone has a fantastic day.
Thank you so much, Dr. Katz. That was a really awesome overview of priapism and review of the literature and great overview of what we know and don't know about it. I'm curious, I've been in a couple of situations where people have sort of partial erections or like some part of the penis is erect and some part not, and maybe they're in pain. And it's hard to tell exactly what's going on in these sort of like nebulous situations. Do you have any advice for approaching sort of if there's diagnostic uncertainty, you're not quite sure what the situation is?
Yeah, this is easy. This is where you get that penile blood gas. Or you can get the ultrasound, but the fastest is going to be that penile blood gas. Very easy.
Perfect. That's a great approach.
All right. That's awesome.
Any other questions from the chat?
So we wanted to let people know that they can post questions on the YouTube comment section. We didn't see any so far. Really very practical, useful information you've given us, though, that the next time we see a case like this, we'll be able to use this information right away. Super helpful. So folks, if you post a comment or a question in the comment area for YouTube, we'll be glad to ask it if we have the time. Terrific. Any last words you want to, any final takeaway point you want to give?
No, I think I gave a bunch. All right. Well, I hope everyone has a wonderful day.
All right. Thank you so much.
Much, Dr. Kat. Next up, we have more, I guess, adult themed emergency medicine from one of our toxicology colleagues, Dr. Jennifer Love. She's from the Mount Sinai Hospital, where she's currently halfway through a research fellowship. She comes to us to New York from University of Pennsylvania Medical School and then Oregon Health Sciences University. And we're really excited to welcome her and really looking forward to this talk. So thanks so much, Dr. Love.
Awesome. Good morning, everybody. I am really excited to be here. I'm just going to put out the apology in advance. My daughter's classroom was literally just shut down for COVID 5 minutes ago. So if there's some explosive noise in the background, that's what it is. The topic of my talk today is myth busting the sedative hypnotics. And I am really excited to talk to you about this morning. I am a medical toxicologist and emergency medicine doc at Mount Sinai Hospital and currently a clinical research fellow, where I am researching mostly opioid use disorder, but also enjoy all things related to toxicology. So my goals for us this morning are, one, to present four clinical myths around sedative hypnotics and unpack some of the evidence that exists for each, and to offer you some alternative options for the management and treatment of sedative hypnotic patient exposures in the emergency department. And my final goal is to show you the fewest number of chemical structures and cartoons of the electron transport chain as one possibly can in a toxicology lecture. I couldn't leave them out entirely, but I promise to do my best to keep them to a minimum. So when most people think of sedative hypnotics, they often stop listening because they think of maybe only alcohol or benzos and maybe your barbiturates. But there is truly so much diversity among the sedative hypnotic agents that they're really an exciting category of drugs to talk about. Of course, we have your renowned benzos and barbs, but there's also things like your growing cohort of sleep aid Z drugs like Zolpidem, everyone's favorite critical care sedative hypnotic propofol, your sort of ancient sedative hypnotics like chloral hydrate, which was used as an anesthetic agent and a quote unquote early date rape drug in the famed Mickey Finn. You have your re-emerging sedative hypnotics like GHB and Quaaludes. And you have your quickly emerging sedative hypnotics that sort of find themselves into other forms of technology and use, like your baclofen pumps and things like dexmedetomidine. So it's really like a lot of diversity. There's even more things that I left out of this slide, and they're a fun category of drugs to talk about. So let's throw ourselves all the way back to studying for step one in medical school and review everybody's favorite receptor, the GABA receptor. GABA itself, if you remember, is an inhibitory neurotransmitter that's derived from glutamate. And your GABA-A receptors are a gated ion channel, and opening that ion channel increases the amount of chloride that flows through it, and it leads to this neuroinhibition. And as you can see in this image of your GABA-A receptor, it shows that there's a true tremendous diversity of sedative hypnotic agents that bind to that GABA-A channel. All of those individual circles represent different GABA receptor binding drugs. Some of these drugs require GABA to open the channel. So for example, benzos are GABA dependent, but other drugs like propofol or barbiturates can actually open the channel themselves at high concentrations and are not GABA dependent. And that becomes relevant later on. We also have, though, the highly underappreciated, but still very interesting and important GABA-B receptor, which is relevant to some of our other sedative hypnotics, things like baclofen, for example. And this is a G protein coupled receptor, not an ion gated channel. So that's all I've got for your pathophysiology right now, but just consider these when we're talking about some of our myths coming up. So the first myth to tackle here, and my first question for all of you is, true or false, acute alcohol withdrawal requires just benzos, benzos, and more benzos. And there are different components to alcohol withdrawal. I don't necessarily consider them phases because they don't always follow in order. The one that we can see as early as 6 hours since sobriety is your alcoholic tremulousness. And that's sort of your eye opener state where patients will sort of sleep and have this brief period of sobriety and need that eye opener in the morning. It's characterized by that increased autonomic activity that we see, things like tachycardia, a little bit of hypertension, some psychomotor agitation, and then a very emotional lability, being very anxious and irritable. Alcoholic hallucinosis is really interesting. It is a subset of transient hallucinations that are associated with alcohol withdrawal. So people can get sort of transient hallucinations, seeing your classic pink elephants or that foamication where they feel like bugs are crawling all over them. Those can be hallucinations, but the thing that is different about alcoholic hallucinosis is that it can last a much longer time. And that time period can be up to weeks. And the other thing about alcoholic hallucinosis, which distinguishes it from something like delirium tremens, is that they describe people as having a clear sensorium. So they're able to concentrate or focus attention. They're able to answer your questions, even if they may be seeing some of these things or experiencing some of these tactile hallucinations, that their judgment is not entirely clouded or entirely absent. Alcohol withdrawal seizures are something I think we are all pretty familiar with. They can be the first sign of alcohol withdrawal that we encounter in the emergency department, as that seizure is what brings a patient to our care. And they are generally self-limited. They may require one dose of benzodiazepines, but they certainly don't require any anti-epileptics. So please don't load your patient with phenytoin if they're having alcohol withdrawal seizures. And then finally, sort of our favorite category of delirium tremens, which patients can experience at approximately 48 to 96 hours since their last drink. And it's characterized by sort of two features. One is that increase in autonomic activity, but the second is this disturbed consciousness or cognitive change. And like I said, compared to your alcoholic hallucinosis, these patients, they cannot focus. They seem to have a memory deficit or a language disturbance that's not explained by something like a pre-existing condition or new or early onset dementia. And that's really the heart of delirium tremens. So for many ED patients who present with acute alcohol withdrawal, especially if they are seizing, someone somewhere in the emergency department is running and shouting, "I've got the Ativan." And benzos are a great initial way to start rapid treatment for your alcohol withdrawal patient, but they're not the only way. Certainly us junior tox fellows have had both former tox fellows and EM docs who trained at Bellevue who can recount standing at the bedside and doubling the dose of diazepam every 2 to 3 minutes for patients with severe alcohol withdrawal. And others have described to me times where they've given over 100 milligrams in a single dose to control withdrawal. And patients have been reported to frequently get more than 200 milligrams in the first 24 hours of hospital admission. But I want to offer to you that there is another option, and that is phenobarbital. So phenobarbital is a drug that also binds your GABA-A receptor, so that chloride ion channel, and it opens the channel for a longer period of time, and it is GABA independent. So it does not require GABA as a cofactor for the inhibitory effects on that channel. Typically, I would say we load people with about 260 milligrams of phenobarbital, and then we'll give repeated dosing of 130 milligrams at PRN. The time to peak on phenobarbital is between 20 and 40 minutes. So usually I'm not dosing it, that PRN dosing, I'm not giving more than every hour or so. But it is something that I have done before, of giving a couple of PRN doses. So what does the evidence show for phenobarbital? It's actually pretty good. In this 2013 study, it was a prospective, randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled trial, so really good methods, and patients were randomized to receive either a single dose of IV phenobarbital of 10 mg per kg or a placebo of just 100 milliliters of normal saline. And the primary outcome that they looked at was the initial level of hospital admission, so whether the patient went to the ICU or telemetry or the floor. 51 patients received phenobarbital and 51 patients received the placebo. And what they found was a statistically significant decrease in the number of ICU admissions and the number of patients who required continuous lorazepam infusions among those who were treated with phenobarbital as compared to the placebo group. It also sort of naturally follows that the average dose of lorazepam that was given IV in the phenobarb group was 26 milligrams versus 49 milligrams in the placebo group. And I think it's interesting because, you know, certainly we can see, particularly if patients are in the ICU receiving repeated dosing of Ativan and certainly higher dosing of, of a benzodiazepine and higher dosing of a benzodiazepine, we can see things like sundowning, ICU-related delirium, delirium related to the continuous benzo infusion. And so sort of promising that phenobarb was helpful in this situation. In this 2020 study, the team conducted a small retrospective chart review of patients who had received lorazepam or lorazepam plus one dose of phenobarbital for alcohol withdrawal management. Again, it was a pretty small study, so only 78 patients were included, but they found the significantly higher rates of discharge within 3 days if the patient had received a dose of phenobarb as opposed to receiving lorazepam only. And then finally, this study is pretty recent. It's published within this year, and it was done by one of our medical toxicologists at Columbia and a good colleague of mine. And it was a retrospective chart review of alcohol withdrawal patients who were actually discharged from the emergency department over 4 years at a single hospital in San Francisco. And the team looked at the rates of ED return for patients who had received either benzodiazepines, phenobarbital, or a combination of benzos and phenobarb in the emergency department and then were discharged. And their results, again, were really interesting. What they found was that phenobarb alone or in combination with benzos decreased the rate of return within 3 days to the emergency department by a pretty significant amount, and sort of suggests that also among patients who, you know, are there for alcohol withdrawal, but may be patients who are going to be discharged or that you anticipate discharging, providing phenobarbital as an adjunct or even alone is a good option for these patients. So this brings me to my first learning point, which is consider transitioning early or sort of adjunctively giving phenobarbital in the management of your patients with alcohol withdrawal. So my next myth for you guys is one that's a favorite of mine. If the urine drug screen is negative for benzos, the patient didn't take benzos. True or false? It's a statement I will let you reflect on a little bit, but I certainly have strong opinions on, and I'll hop on my soapbox for a couple of minutes to tell you guys about them. So urine drug screens or urine drug amino assays are great for very specific things. They are quick. We get them back certainly within, you know, a patient's ED visit. They're inexpensive, which is wonderful, but they are a very poor drug for figuring out exactly what is going on. They are pretty nonspecific. They are a qualitative test, which means that you cannot find out the amount, and they have cutoff values. So if you don't have the amount detectable in the urine, the test may come back negative, even if it is the substance is present, but at a very small concentration. And then the other thing that I didn't really realize or learn until I was the toxicology fellow is that these drug amino assays, these urine drug amino assays can vary with the brand, when they were produced, what company your lab is ordering from. So you could have a test on a Monday that is coming from a specific brand and then your lab runs out and rapid orders tests from a different company, and the immunoassay will be completely potentially different and detecting different metabolites or different substances. And you run that test on a Friday and you could get totally different results. So when we think about the results of a urine drug screen that either does or does not have, for example, benzodiazepines, there are a couple questions you have to ask yourself first, what could be masquerading as a benzo? And the literature has shown that a few drugs have sort of produced these false positives on urine drug immunoassays, things like sertraline. We have seen NSAIDs, methadone, cogentin, and propoxyphene, which is an old opioid, that have all been detected as false positives on urine drug screens. Next, you also have to consider what you might be missing. So first, for example, like I said, the urine concentration of the drug that you're testing could be too low, either due to the timing of the ingestion, the manipulation of a urine specimen, the dose that somebody ingested. So you could be missing it just because your concentration isn't high enough for that qualitative assay. Your qualitative assay also might not be testing for all of the possible drugs or metabolites that are related to benzodiazepines. If you look at this graphic here, you can see that not all benzos are metabolized to the same detectable metabolite. For example, if you look at the bottom, things like lorazepam is glucuronidated, and so its metabolite is lorazepam glucuronide, and clonazepam is metabolized to a completely different metabolite. And some of the other ones, things like oxazepam, diazepam, sort of fall into a similar category of metabolites. But you really need to make sure that your test is not just detecting one metabolite or the most common metabolites, that is detecting sort of the variety of things that you might be seeing. And then finally, you might just be dealing with a novel designer benzodiazepine, and these are sort of up and coming benzos that are created by chemists to escape the traditional immunoassays, and it's usually by fluorinating the compound in some way, and we'll take a look at some of these in a little bit. So let's just talk a few minutes about designer benzodiazepines. National data from the National Poison Center Database has demonstrated significant growth in the frequency and the diversity of agents in the last decade. This study looked at the characteristics and distributions of designer benzos in the United States, and it showed some higher concentrations of these agents in places in the Northeast, like in Maine, New Hampshire, and Vermont. Minnesota sort of stands out on this map, as well as Kentucky and Oregon. And in the table, we can see that with each new year, new agents are detected in the exposures that are reported to the National Poison Center Database. And so there are this sort of growing and quote unquote, maybe mutating designer benzodiazepines that are really taking off. And so why are these, what are these compounds and why aren't they showing up in your urine drug screen? Well, as I said, the immunoassay uses a target to bind to a recognized part of the molecule, and chemists will modify the molecule to evade detection. For example, if we look at something like alprazolam, modifications will include the addition of like a bromide or a fluoride to the rings, and you get something like flubromazolam, which it maintains the physiologic properties of the molecule and can produce the same clinical effects that you would expect with a benzo, but it limits the immunoassay detection. These exposures have certainly been described in case reports and case series, particularly in the pediatric literature, so as to alert physicians about emerging trends in adolescent substance misuse. In this case series that was done by Dr. Blumenberg from the Columbia University, he described a case series of six teenagers who ingested what they thought was counterfeit alprazolam from a single student. They all purchased it from this one student at the same high school. And the students presented to the emergency department with slurred speech, some mild respiratory depression, significant lethargy. Luckily, all of them recovered within 6 hours and they were all discharged, but we were able to do, or they were able to do some blood and urine sampling, as well as get a piece of the bar that they ingested, the quote unquote Hulk bar that they said that they were taking. And it was both the tablet and three out of the six students had detectable flu alprazolam. So some novel benzos popping up in this group. In this study, we actually described three kids who ingested what they thought was Pez candy, had been pressed, and it turned out to be Etisalam. And despite ingesting the same pills all at approximately the same time, and two of the three children had pretty severe symptoms, only one child had a positive benzo urine drug immunoassay at the time of care in the emergency department. So sort of speaking to, like I said, differences in timing of collection of your substance and concentrations, and also just the novel agents not really showing up super well, that sort of limit the strength of your urine immunoassay for, you know, benzos, but also a lot of other substances. So this brings me to my next key learning point, which is to rely on your clinical and critical thinking for detection of benzos in the emergency department, not your urine drug screen. All right, my next true or false for you is the statement flumazenil is a trash drug. And at the beginning of February, Dr. Alex Koivman crowdsourced Twitter to ask people for pearls about using flumazenil in the emergency department. And there were a lot of negative answers about how it should never be used, or it has never needs to be used, including this one meme response, which just suggested that flumazenil should be thrown out in the trash. But I would disagree on surrendering your flumazenil to Oscar the Grouch, and argue that there are key situations where it's absolutely necessary to keep that flumazenil in your Pyxis. So flumazenil is a competitive GABA-A receptor antagonist, and it binds to a subunit of GABA-A receptor to prevent any benzoagonist from binding and acting at that chloride channel. And the reason that people fear it is that by removing that inhibitory effect and using it as a competitive antagonist, you can precipitate excitatory activity, including things like seizures. And seizures are pretty scary in the ER. But what does the data say? Should we consider using it, or is this the world's most dangerous seizure-inducing drug that ever existed? And we should, like I said, throw it out in the trash. Well, the data sort of speaks a little bit differently, and that there are important opportunities for it. This study was a retrospective 10-year review of cases that were reported to the California Poison Center system. That's for the entire state of California. And they looked at cases that described using flumazenil in subjects that were older than 18 years of age. And interestingly, what they found was in 904 patients over 10 years, only 13 subjects were described as developing seizures, and that's 1.4% of their total population. 9 out of the 13 had seizures following pretty closely in timing after flumazenil administration, and the other 4, there was this time delay that sort of suggested that maybe the seizure was not flumazenil related. Also interestingly was that 226 subjects were reported to have received flumazenil without having any sort of known drug exposure. Either it was unknown if they were there for a possible ingestion or overdose, or no drug was ever reported. And in those 226 patients, there were 0 seizures and 0 deaths. So I like to think that that data suggests that maybe there's a little bit more safety margin in using flumazenil in patients than we might imagine. But we should also think about it in the poison pediatric patient, because the pediatric patients are often the population that is 1, benzo naive, and 2, likely to accidentally ingest the pills that grandma dropped on the floor. So let's look at the data on its safe use in pediatrics. This was part of that first study that I described. Again, it was a retrospective case review over a 10-year period of cases that were reported to the California Poison Center. Again, and this was looking at flumazenil use in patients that were aged 12 or younger. So not just your tiny toddlers, but a decent size pediatric age range. And what they found was it was described in 83 patients over 10 years. So not that many that were that received it. The median age was 2 years old, so certainly your younger group. But over that time period, there were 0 flumazenil-associated seizures. There was 1 seizure reported, but the time interval between the flumazenil and the seizure was about 4 hours. And the researchers who reviewed the case felt like this was not an associated seizure. So 0 flumazenil-associated seizures and 0 deaths. So I think the learning point here, and the thing I want you guys to take away, is don't throw your flumazenil away. Just know when to use it. On a personal story note, those kids who ate the Pez candy were about to be intubated when the PEMDOC called me and asked if they should try giving flumazenil. And sort of in the clinical context and thinking about possibly, you know, the related dangers and harms and complications of intubating to children under the age of 10, we agreed to give a trial dose, and it worked. It helped to prevent them from getting intubated. It helped allow them to be safely transported via medical flight to the pediatric ICU in Portland. It avoided any unnecessary procedures that may have been done, things like lumbar punctures or MRIs. It avoided a prolonged ICU stay in the middle of COVID when beds in the PICU were pretty resource limited. And so I would say, based on the both personal experience that I have, but also based on some of this evidence that I presented to you, don't just throw that flumazenil away. Keep it in your Pyxis and just know when to use it. And then my last topic that I want to talk to you guys about today is this sort of true or false. Some old school sedative hypnotics are making a comeback. So the first one I want to just touch on a little bit is Quaaludes. The only previous reference that I really had to Quaaludes before Tox Fellowship was from The Wolf of Wall Street, where Leonardo DiCaprio's character is using Quaaludes regularly to sort of counterbalance the pounds of cocaine that he's misusing. But Quaaludes, or methaqualone and its derivatives, and it was a sedative hypnotic drug that was first available in 1965 and being used for things like insomnia, but quickly became misused and used recreationally, and then was later removed from the market in 1984. So it was really only around for about 20 years, quote unquote, legally, and it's now included in the list of Schedule I drugs. Is a GABA-A receptor binder. And in overdose, we see things like CNS depression, which you would expect, but also some of these like peripheral musculoskeletal effects, things like clonus, hyperreflexia, and seizures. And like I said, while it was removed from the market in 1984, there are these sort of pop-up case reports in the literature that describe exposure to Quaaludes, particularly a Quaalude derivative called SL-164. You can buy anything on the internet these days, as a lot of us know. And so these patients describe purchasing the product on the internet for its misuse, and their exposure resulted in things like agitated delirium, myoclonic jerking, and hyperreflexia. Luckily, both patients were responsive to benzodiazepine treatment, and there were no adverse effects, but they sent the samples for additional testing, and methaqualone was detected in both tablet analysis and blood sampling. So Quaaludes are sort of around. If you see somebody that you're thinking could be a sedative hypnotic with some of these musculoskeletal neurologic findings, always feel free to send that, call your poison center, send that specimen for extra testing, because you may encounter something that you haven't really expected and sort of is a fun historical find. And then my next favorite and last one that I want to talk to you guys about is something called Phenibut. It is a drug that is used primarily for anxiolysis or insomnia, and it is approved in places like Russia and the Ukraine, but is not approved in either the European Union or the United States. But it's something we actually saw from time to time in Oregon. And this one binds to that significantly underappreciated GABA-B receptor, and is structurally similar to baclofen. So if we look at the structure of GHB and we look at the structure of baclofen and Phenibut, they all are sort of pretty similar. And as you would expect, then you can see sort of in overdose things like sedation and delirium. But more often what we would get cases of were people misusing this for their anxiolysis and then abruptly stopping it because they lost access to it, and having severe withdrawal. And that can include things like severe agitation, diaphoresis, anxiety, severe irritability. But the good news is that because of the structural similarity, you can use things like baclofen, benzos, gabapentin tapers, sort of people maybe on prolonged tapers due to the amount that they are misusing. But there are options to treat them in the emergency department with things that we do have access to. But it is sort of a drug that is out there and that you may hear about or may see in your patients. So the last key learning point there is that some old sedative hypnotics are the new sedative hypnotics. And so that's all I have for you guys today. I think the four key learning points I really wanted you guys to take away are: consider transitioning early to that phenobarbital in your alcohol withdrawal patients. Rely on your clinical thinking for detection of benzos, not your urine drug screen. Don't throw that flumazenil out, just know when to use it. And finally, watch for some of those old school sedative hypnotics that might be making a comeback. And thank you. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Dr. Love, that was fantastic. Such great, practical, useful information. We all are always so impressed with you toxicologists and your knowledge of all that molecular stuff that makes us, some of us anyway, glaze over a little bit, but we think it's really cool. And I do think it reinforces the endless creativity of humanity, that people can keep tinkering with some little piece of a molecule and make a brand new designer drug. So I guess one question I have to ask you, which isn't exactly what you covered, but you talked about the Utox, which I know my residents know is one of my, like, my eyes dilate when it drives me absolutely crazy that people ask for it all the time, and it seems so important to so many people. So I have to ask you the opposite question. Is there a time when it's actually useful? Is it like what people thought about flumazenil? Should we just throw it in the garbage? Or like you're saying about flumazenil, does it actually have a use?
Yeah, it definitely does. I sort of joke, like, also with my residents that it's a completely useless test, but there are times where it is really important. So there are two times where if your urine drug screen is positive for a substance, it is a true positive. So the one is cocaine, the metabolite of cocaine. There's nothing that is really produces a false positive on that. And so if that's a positive, it's a true positive. And the other one would be fentanyl. That test is pretty specific now. I would say that I don't, like, similarly, don't universally run them on adults, but in children, that is the one place where if you clinically are not really sure what's going on, or if there's concerns related to domestic issues at home, that is a appropriate place to run it, because even if the qualitative assay comes up negative, like you don't meet that threshold concentration for a positive on the qualitative, if there's anything detectable, it's something that needs to be looked at further. And so most of our pediatric ICU patients or PEM patients where we were consulted, we would routinely get them because it is a pretty important patient population to examine it closely in.
Excellent point. Definitely an excellent point. I'll ask you one more question about phenobarb. So that's a new one for me. Really, I love when I come away from these talks with something new. You say transition early. Now, one of the things that I've done in my practice is change to using diazepam pretty commonly because of its long-acting metabolites. And I always worry about what I do and then what happens on the floor, so I don't get to keep them, right? So when would I use, like, if let's say I did two doses of 40 milligrams of IV diazepam, which I can only do without a phone call and if my ED pharmacist is there, and I've gotten some good control, and now I'm thinking, is this the time for me to add phenobarb? And then what do I tell my upstairs team about how they should continue that?
That's a great question. I think it is really hard because phenobarb is not something that a lot of people are used to using. And I've certainly been in the position where I've even started them on phenobarb in the ER, and then they're switched back to benzos when they get to the floor. I think the ICUs are a little more comfortable with it, so that might affect your decision-making. Usually what I do, I just do 20 milligrams of diazepam. Diazepam is a great choice because it has a short time to effect, but the metabolites do last a long time. So it's really good for acute alcohol withdrawal. But if I'm not seeing an effect, you know, 15, 20 minutes after giving that big dose of diazepam, I'll switch to phenobarbital because I do feel like it gets a nice, smoother control of the withdrawal management. And then sort of, you can still follow along with the CWA protocol that most nursing and upstairs clinicians are comfortable with in terms of reassessment. Then I just sort of try to guide them that, you know, we've added phenobarb on, the dosing for it is 130 milligrams for repeated dosing. It's the same way that you'd sort of judge your CWA or RAS score if you're in the ICU, but just to offer that as an option to try to continue the phenobarb as opposed to just sticking with benzos. And like I said, I think in our ICUs in Oregon, they were more comfortable with that sort of diversity. They also did things in the GOLD protocol like gabapentin and dexmedetomidine and whatnot. So they were comfortable with phenobarb, but it is a little bit more of a struggle for just the inpatient units, which is sort of where you're hoping the patient will go by starting phenobarb. So we can do more education and teaching about its use to those groups. I hope that it can become more of a staple in the treatment.
One of the criticisms I've heard about phenobarb from other toxicologists is that it, you know, there's a specific degree of inducible metabolism, but you don't really know how active metabolizer you're going to have. Is there any dosing adjustment you do based on sort of like duration of action or clinical response, or just sort of keep giving 130s as a bolus dose PRNs?
I've traditionally just done the 130, both for the inpatient on the inpatient side, but I think it's a great question that we need more prospective data on, is to really see how to finesse the dosing a little bit better.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it. Great talk. So next up, we have Dr. Mark Silverberg, who's going to give us a very adult talk. Sometimes being a grown-up isn't just about sex and drugs. It's also about dealing with difficult situations. And I know that there was recently quite a difficult situation at Jacoby Hospital, and many of you know about it. And I'm not sure it's really been talked about as much as it should be. And we at All NYC felt like it was really important to at least address the topic. And so Dr. Silverberg is gonna talk to us about dealing with the active shooter in the emergency department. Just to say, I've known Dr. Silverberg for longer than some of you've been alive. And we've known each other since med school. He is SUNY Downstate to his bones, from med school to through residency, SUNY Downstate KCH, and served as APD there for many years, and recently stepped aside to take over the disaster medicine program there. So no further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Silverberg.
Thank you so much, Laura, for that introduction. So today I'm going to talk to you about the active shooter. And again, my name is Mark Silverberg. I'm the clinical professor of emergency medicine, and I'm the director of disaster preparedness at SUNY Downstate and Kings County Hospital. Oh, why did that go blue? Nothing like tech problems. Excellent. So our aim today and the objectives we're going to cover are the definition of an active shooter, and then we'll talk a little bit about some of the statistics of active shooters, especially hospital-based ones, because that's what we worry about. And then I want you to think about what will you do if you're ever involved in an active shooter incident, and this could definitely save your life. And then at the end, we'll talk about being a post-event provider, just in case that you are involved in an active shooter event, not in the shooting, but afterwards. I have to put in my financial disclosure slide. Everybody has to do that. I love this Spanish proverb. Of course, I have none. I wish I did. And if you know of anything, please, of course, let me know. So this is a picture of our campus I took with my nice new drone. And I put this in there because this is where I train. This is where I work. And I want you to think about what you would do if there was an active shooter event at your campus. Right? Think about it for a drop. We're going to get back to that in a little bit. But it could mean the difference between life and death having a plan. So taken from the FBI website, an active shooter is an individual actively engaging in killing or attempting to kill people in a confined and populated area. Unfortunate for us, active shooter events are on the rise. And some may blame it due to COVID, but I don't think anybody knows why these events really happen, but they're just going up. So if you look at the timing of the events in 2020, a large number of them happened in the month of June. Additionally, quite a few of them happen on Saturdays. So if I were you, I would ask for Saturdays in June off for the next couple of years. If you look at where these events happened in 2020, there were 40 active shooter incidents, and a lot of them happened in California and Illinois. I'm not sure what's going on in those states, but that's where they occurred. Happened in 19 different states total. There are 126 people wounded in these 40 events. 38 people were shot dead, including one police officer. So let's look at the shooters. 35 were male, 3 were female, and 4 were unknown. Their ages ran from 15 to 87. And 15, I kind of get, you know, middle school, high school is kind of a tough place. Kids are mean, and I get it, but 87-year-old shooters, that's just crazy to me. 7 of these shooters committed suicide at the end, so they actually had no plan of being captured. They were going until it was done, and then they were just going to kill themselves afterwards. 24 of the shooters were captured. 2 were shot by PD. 2 were shot by citizens. In one of these cases I read where an active shooter ran into a church someplace in the South and shot a bunch of people, ran out, and all the people in the church got in their cars, chased the guy down, pulled him out of his car, and shot him at the roadside. I can't say I advocate for this, and it's a little bit crazy to me that these things happen. 5 active shooters still at large. They never caught them. Either they don't know who they are, or they just were not able to catch them. Also a little bit crazy to me. So where does it happen? When did active shooter events take place? Well, the most common one is in the businesses, and it's usually the workplace of the shooter due to some argument, either with a coworker or a boss. They can happen in schools and then also on government properties. And I'm sure you guys all know the saying, going postal. This is what happens there. But that can also happen in open spaces and in healthcare facilities, which is what bothers me and worries me. And then, of course, also in houses of worship. This is our danger, right? 5 events happened inside a hospital in 2017. Another 2 more in 2019. And of course, the Jacoby incident in 2021. But this is really our danger. 29% of these events happened in the ED and 23% in the parking lot. That's more than 50% of these episodes happening where we, the ER docs, are working. This scares the bejesus out of me. All right, so let's switch gears and now talk about what you should do if you're in an incident. And this is a really scary slide. I put it up there on purpose because I want to make you think about what would happen if you were in an active shooter event. Being prepared is the key to survival. So if you look at any website and any teaching on it, your options are run, hide, or fight. And there's a bunch of different companies that put out like programs on this. They use different words. But this is pretty much the gist of what you should do. And this is the order you should do it in. Run, hide, and then fight. The first thing you should do is run out of there. It's always your first option. Run in the opposite direction of the gunshots. Sometimes people get kind of confused and maybe running towards them. Maybe you want to help them out and direct them in the opposite direction. Don't wait for an announcement over the PA system. It's possible that the person running the PA system is already out of the building and you'll never hear them talk. If you have to do a vertical evacuation, don't take an elevator, use the stairs. I can't think of anything worse than getting in an elevator on the 5th floor and pressing 1 and the doors open on 3 and there's the active shooter standing right in front of you. You're standing in a little metal box and there is no place to run with the active shooter directly in front of you. At least if you're on the steps, if you're going down and they come into the staircase, you can go back up and try and get away from them. You should have an exit plan. Every place that you spend a lot of time in, at work or at home, you should know at least 2 different ways to get out of that area just in case one is blocked off. This could mean a difference of life or death. If you're running out, leave your belongings behind. I promise you they'll still be there when you get back. Active shooters are not looking to steal your stuff. They're looking to kill people. Keep your hands visible. In this picture, you have all the students with their phones in their hand. I really don't like that. I don't want you having anything in your hands at all, especially something that's dark in color that could be mistaken for a gun. You have to remember, when these things happen, the SWAT team is coming in to neutralize the active shooter. They're looking at every single person's hands because the active shooter could be mixed in with the people there. So if they see something dark in your hands, you don't want them to confuse you with the active shooter. That could be a bad outcome. Help others if possible. Try and run with them. Try and get them to go. Occasionally, people may freeze if an active shooter event is going on because they don't know what to do. As you're running past them, tap them on the back. Give them a little push on the shoulder. Get them going in the right direction. Help others get out of there. And then warn people what's going on. They may not know. As you're running out, say the words, active shooter. Keep talking about it as you're leaving the building and get other people to go out with you. And then, of course, when PD comes into the place, these guys are trying to neutralize the shooter. So if they say get down or run in the other direction, not the one you're going, they probably have a reason for that. And if they say get down, you probably should. They may be about to take a shot. If you can't run and there's no place, no safe way to get out, then you want to find a place to hide or barricade yourself in. Pick an unlikely spot where you'll avoid detention, right? Make sure it's a place where the doors lock. If the doors don't lock, you can always put a chair across it like you see in the picture here. Putting furniture in front of the door may also help, right? Because you want to make as many layers of things between you and the bullets as you possibly can to slow them down and stop them, right? And then you want to wait for the police department to clear the building. Don't open the door for anybody unless you're sure it's the police. Pick a good spot to hide. Bathrooms are good because they have locks. The medication room in your ED, janitor's closets have nice thick doors and a lock, but stay out of view. Don't be peeking out the window in an office to see if the active shooter is out there, because if you can see them, they can see you. Stay low on the floor. Most active shooters are shooting at the core body. So if you're on the floor, the bullets may sail over your head and not hit you. Silence your phone, make sure it's off. The last thing you need is somebody calling you when the active shooter is taking shots around you. And then don't bring any electronics in the cabinet with you or in the closet with you, just because they make noise. I did read one interesting paper that talked about a guy who locked himself in an office and he dragged a TV in from outside. But of course, the TV's extension cord was running outside the office, leading exactly to where he was. This was super not helpful because it showed where the active shooter, where he was. If you have a belt on that can be used in more than one way to help out, you could put a belt across the control arms of the door that'll help lock the door and not let the active shooter in for you if the door opens inwards. Additionally, you can wrap it around the door handles of the door lock, and that'll also keep the active shooter out, hopefully. If you can't run and you can't hide, your last choice is to fight. Now, you're fighting against an active shooter. It's a guy with a gun. Most of us don't carry guns, although I have heard some people do in our departments, but most don't. If you're discovered in a hiding spot, you may also be forced to fight. So a lot of people I've heard talking to the subject say, be bold, be aggressive. It may take the shooter by surprise. The shooter is expecting them to be in control and you to be cowering. And if you're not cowering, then you take them by surprise. It may confuse them. If you can, band together and come at the shooter from all sides. This may be helpful. Maybe one of you will get injured, but the others will take the shooter down. And then try and find a weapon. Weapons are all around the hospital. You can hold something that you find there. Fire extinguishers are a great idea, right? These have a long range. And if you can get stuff in their eyes, you may be able to blind them so they can't take a shot. Additionally, it'll fill the room with a gas that they can't see through and they can't see where you are. If they can't see you, they can't shoot you either. One of the FBI agents I heard talking to said you should always have a hammer in your drawer of your desk. I actually do, but it's to fix things and work on things, but I have it there for whatever reason I might need it. Remember too, that a hammer is legal and most guns or knives, edge blades are not legal on our campuses. Find any object you can that's heavy you can injure the shooter with. Furniture works great. Again, fire extinguishers, nice and heavy, you can heft it at them. But try not to use anything that's sharp. It gets you too close to the active shooter and you risk getting injured. Band together, you want to grab the barrel of the gun as the shooter comes into the room. Pull the gun straight to the ground, including the barrel, and then everybody can jump on top of them. You want to throw things at the active shooter as well. This may confuse them or hurt them or injure them just long enough for them to loosen their grip and you can pull the gun out of their hands. But pull it down to the ground, pull the shooter down to the ground. And if everybody gets on top of him, you have a good chance of winning that fight. Here's another picture of people throwing stuff at the active shooter. It's a good way to get things done. All right, let's switch gears now and talk about being the post-event provider. So with any trauma, you guys are ER docs, you know how to do this. You do your ABCs, but remember, in an active shooter event, people may get shot more than once. There may be more than one injury. So you want to control the bleeding as best you can. And we're going to talk about that specifically in a second. You want to resuscitate them, get an IV in them, give them fluids, give them blood. And then a lot of people are going to need angiograms depending on where the bullet path goes. And we'll talk about that in a second too. You want to upgrade their tetanus and give them antibiotics. Remember that bullets can bounce off of concrete walls. They take secondary missiles into the wound with them. They're going through clothing and none of that stuff is sterile. Even a bullet, when it's fired out of a gun, people say it's hot enough to be sterile. This is not a true statement. And then always think about TXA in your trauma patients. So controlling bleeding. I put this picture in there because this is the exact wrong thing to do, right? This person still has their clothing on. You can't see where the hole is. They're using the palm of their hand and a lot of gauze piled up and they're just bleeding through it. Here's the right way to do it. The clothing is exposed and taken off so you can see the skin. You can see exactly where the hole is. The gauze is rolled up into a nice tight spot and you're using your fingertips to push the gauze into the hole. This will hopefully stop the bleeding and tamponade it off so you don't lose more blood than you have to lose. If direct pressure fails, you can always go to a tourniquet. This is a nice CAT tourniquet that you can buy online that a lot of companies give out in their courses for active shooter events. It works pretty well and it's made special so you can put it on with one hand so you can put it on yourself. I will say one hint to these, when you put them on pretty tight to start with. And then when you crank down the crank, the windlass will turn it tight and it should stop bleeding. You're supposed to turn the crank until bleeding stops. That's when you know it's tight enough. I know it may be tight and hurt the patient, but it will stop the bleeding eventually. I will say one thing about homemade tourniquets. If you don't have a pre-bought tourniquet or a pre-made tourniquet, you can make them yourself. But there is some literature that says they don't work. They definitely don't work as well as the store-bought ones. But if that's all you have, that's all you have. Basically, what you want to do is take a piece of cloth, fold it up into a wide band, not something narrow because you don't want it to cut into the skin. Build a crank out of some sort of wood or hard material, popsicle sticks are used here, and turn it until the bleeding stops. You can then take another piece of cloth and tie it around the end so it won't untie and you won't have any issues with it. This is a cool object that I never heard about until I started writing this lecture. It's called a junctional tourniquet. And pretty much the military uses these. I've never seen them used outside. But if you're shot someplace close to the junction where an extremity meets the trunk, it's very hard to put pressure on the area. You can't gain proximal control because you can't get a tourniquet in front of it. So you want to use one of these devices. But the only place I've ever seen them used is in the military. Pretty much just know they exist. I don't expect you to have them or know how to use them. This is a picture from a resuscitation I did many, many years ago, back when our ED was still in the old C building. This is a guy who was shot in the axilla. And we couldn't get the tourniquet proximal to his wound. We couldn't gain control. And we kept giving this guy blood, but he kept losing it. And this is a tremendous amount of blood loss for a small little single wound in the axilla. But just realize that people are going to bleed a lot. You need to be ready to deal with this. You have to have big lines in them to give them blood, to give them fluid, and get them up to the OR as quickly as you can. So here's a nice shot of an angiogram we did a couple years back. And you can see there's a huge hematoma on the side of the leg. And you can see the bullet path going through the tib and the fib. But if you look here, you can also see one of the trunks off the trifurcation has an abrupt cutoff. Now, this may stop bleeding initially because the vessel goes into spasm. However, if that spasm releases before you're ready to deal with it, they may start to lose blood again. So you want to make sure these guys get angiograms so they can coil off one of these injuries, and then they won't bleed at a later time when you're not ready for it. So let's review. There are too many of these incidents going on today. They happen in businesses, schools, and government buildings most common, but they can happen in other places like open places and malls. Handguns are worse than rifles because there are many more of them and it's easy to conceal. Although from the patient's point of view, they do cause less damage because they have slower muzzle velocities. Hospitals can be targeted, and this is our worst nightmare. Your choices are run, then hide, then fight if you're ever in one of these situations. Do your ABCs, control bleeding, and get them definitive care. Look for many injuries, and don't forget the rule of trauma. Holes plus bullets has to be an even number. If you see a patient with one gunshot wound, but you x-ray them and find two bullets, that's an odd number, you've missed something. Go back over the patient, look to see if there's an extra hole or an extra bullet that you've missed someplace. I thank everybody for listening. And please, if there are any questions, I'll take them now.
Thanks, Mark. That was a really sobering talk, and I think an excellent view of something we all should at least keep in mind and kind of worry about happening in the workplace and around us. I'm curious if in your experience in reading, you have any kind of thoughts about what sort of institutional best practices are in terms of preparing for such an event, or how to, if there are drills or things people should be doing, and how often we are doing those as institutions in the city.
So like I said before, everybody has a plan of how to get out of their workspace, at least two different ways. A lot of these courses are popping up now and preparing you for active shooter. There's a bunch of them out there. I think that everybody should take at least one of them, and it'll give you a lot of knowledge on how to survive one of these events.
Is this something that ER leadership is doing around, or people like, you know, sending their staff or doing ones inside you, or are there consultants who go around and do things like that? Or is that a thing that's happening yet? Or is that not so much come to pass?
I think it's institution dependent. I know we've done at least two drills on active shooter. I was the doctor for one of them, and I was in three different runs testing our hospital police force. And two of the runs I got out, but one of the runs I did get captured, and I ended up getting shot by the active killer. Which is kind of a scary thing. And like, I consider myself a pretty tough person. And I had PTSD for a week after that event. I mean, the lady was screaming. It was a blue gun, so it was very obviously not real. But it still was really scary to me. So I think that drilling is super important. And you have to just be ready to get out of there. If your hospital doesn't drill, maybe you want to talk to your disaster person, either in your hospital or your department, and get them to help out and maybe run a drill. But I don't think it's ER specific. I think the whole hospital should be doing it.
Yeah. One other question from the chat was, Julie asked if you can easily announce on the PA system there is an active shooter. Should you be doing that? Or is that create more panic or chaos, or alert the shooter they've been located? What's their best practice or recommendations about that?
So there's a lot of conflict about whether you should do it or not. Our hospital just recently changed our policy, and now we do announce it. But like I said before, there's always the possibility that if the page operator hears the gunshots, they're out of there and they're not staying, and it's not going to get announced. So don't wait for an announcement. But most people believe that you should announce it just so everybody knows what's going on and everybody will get out quicker. Some people mentioned pulling a fire alarm on your way out. I think just adds extra noise and adds extra chaos. I'm not sure I can recommend that. And none of the courses that I've taken recommend that. But, you know, I think that it's institution dependent on how you're going to get your people out of the building, that whether they announce it or not.
Very good. Thank you so much for that discussion.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, that was great. Oh, go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Next up before we end for the morning, take a little break, is Dr. Miriam Stone, who's joining us. She is one of the assistant program directors at New York Presbyterian Brooklyn Methodist Hospital, where she also completed residency and has a strong interest in resident education and didactics, and is going to be talking to us today about the cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome. So with that, please, Dr. Stone, welcome.
Thanks. Very happy to be here. All right. So to get things started, so today we're going to talk about cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome. And while I know that this may not seem like the sexiest topic to discuss, especially compared to some of the other lectures that we've heard here today and will hear today, and rest assured, in no way am I going to try to convince you that your patient who is vomiting with reckless abandon is in any way sexy. But for a syndrome that is seemingly so common, we actually don't understand all that much about it. This is being true despite the fact that the syndrome's been prevalent for going on 18 years now, and case presentations to the ED are only increasing in frequency. One enormous challenge to understanding and treating this condition is that many patients and providers aren't really convinced that this is even a thing. And I mean, it is a little confusing. Marijuana is one of the oldest drugs in the world, with its use dating back to 3900 BC. It's also the most widely used illicit drug in the world. So why is it that only recently, over the past 20 years or so, that we've started to see such adverse outcomes from its use? And how is it that we don't know more about how to treat it? And so for this reason, I thought it'd be a good idea to take a closer look, do a slightly deeper dive on the topic, and bring a bit more understanding to this diagnosis. So today we're going to go over cannabinoid hyperemesis, what exactly is it? What treatments do we have that work, if any? What are the pearls and pitfalls to diagnose and treat patients with this? And what education do we need to pass on to our patients? So cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome is a syndrome of cyclic vomiting and abdominal pain associated with chronic high-potency cannabis use. First noted in case reports from 2004 from South Australia, it's thought to be a variant of cyclic vomiting syndrome, and cases have become more prevalent with increasing cannabis use as well as increasing potency of marijuana. And while chronic THC use is a key feature of CHS, the amount of cannabis consumed on any one ingestion does not correlate well with the pattern of illness. While the potency of the ingested THC as well as the chronicity of cannabis use is key. So it's not simply someone ingesting a lot of cannabis that will trigger the symptoms, but rather repeated high potency THC use. About 70% of patients with CHS report daily cannabis use, with about 20% endorsing at least weekly use. And the majority of patients with cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome will have chronic use over 1 year period before they even start to experience any symptoms. So despite all of our imagery of the 60s and 70s occurring under a hazy cloud of pot, the marijuana from then was actually drastically different from the marijuana of today when it comes to THC potency. This increase in potency of marijuana has strongly correlated with our increased rates of CHS and also presents one of the challenges to approaching it. So just for reference, this is from a report from the DEA analyzing samples of marijuana seized and confiscated from 1995 to 2004. And you can see that there's been a drastic increase in THC potency in that time frame, which has been a game changer for us and our patients. The perception that marijuana is a safe and harmless drug comes in part from its longstanding history in the world culture of use and that it's perceived to have very few, if any, adverse effects. However, this was all occurring with a much lower potency strains of marijuana. And as the trend of states legalizing marijuana for recreational use has increased, so has the potency of marijuana, but people still perceive it to be harmless, despite the potency has increased approximately 300% in the past 15 years. This also plays a role in the patient and the physician being able to recognize and understand how marijuana may contribute to symptoms that a patient is presenting with. Also confusing is the paradox that medical marijuana has been used to treat nausea and vomiting for years. This is because medical marijuana has a much lower THC potency when compared to current day cannabis being dispensed legally for recreational use. And it is this high potency cannabis that is responsible for the syndrome of CHS. This notion of treating nausea and vomiting with cannabis also is problematic for our patients who at the onset of their symptoms will often attempt to self-treat with their home high potency cannabis, which only exacerbates their symptoms. All right, so for now, a little bit of the pathophysiology. The pathophysiology of nausea and emesis is actually extremely complex and way beyond the scope of this lecture. So we're just gonna touch on the take-home points, one of which is that innate to our physiology is we have an endocannabinoid system with endogenous cannabinoid receptors that play roles within the CNS and GI tract signaling pathways and is intimately linked with the pathophysiology of nausea and emesis. CHS is thought to occur due to dysregulation of this endocannabinoid system, which is located throughout the CNS, GI tract, and lymphoid tissue in the body. Use of THC activates a variety of cannabinoid receptors within the body, resulting both in psychoactive and physiologic effects. CB1 and CB2 receptors are both located in the central nervous system, as well as the GI tract, and activation of these receptors affects gastric secretion, motility, sensation, and inflammation. Additionally, CB1 receptors interact with the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, which affects the balance of sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system activation. While there's no one singular theory that fully explains CHS, there are at present two main theories of CHS's pathophysiology. So theory one, that the downregulation of CB1 receptors occurs with chronic THC use, causing dysregulation of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, leading to symptoms. And two, that changes in central nervous system dopamine signaling pathways with chronic THC exposure leads to a hypersensitivity emesis response to dopamine. And lastly, an under-recognized and underappreciated but important feature of the pathophysiology of this disorder is to understand that cannabinoids are quite lipophilic and over time with chronic use will accumulate in adipose tissue. This is important to understand because even with the cessation of cannabis use, when the body undergoes lipolysis, either during times of stress or just starvation, stored cannabinoids can be re-released into the system and has the potential to induce symptoms even without active cannabis use. This is crucial and a topic we'll come back to later on in the lecture. And ultimately, also, why is it that some individuals are affected by CHS while others never experience any symptoms? Unclear still. But like anything else in science, when we can't explain why disease appears differently in individuals, we always have genetics to fall back on. But there probably is some truth to that. So how do we approach the evaluation and treatment of these patients? You've got to keep in mind that CHS remains a diagnosis of exclusion with no definitive diagnostic laboratory or imaging studies that will provide you with this diagnosis. Chronic cannabis users can still get appies or colies and need to be fully evaluated before arriving at the diagnosis of CHS. This means that while some testing may be necessary, especially on first-time presentation, getting a good and thorough history is invaluable. This isn't always as simple as it sounds. There are numerous barriers to us getting a good history in the ED, and even more so with cannabinoid hyperemesis patients. Aside from the usual culprits of limited time and endless distractions, there's the fact that your patient is extremely uncomfortable. Patients are often repeatedly vomiting, making a thorough interview extremely challenging. There's also the stigma of marijuana use. While usage of marijuana has gone up and is widely used, many patients are still distrustful of endorsing their marijuana use to physicians. And lastly, there's the perception that marijuana has no adverse effects worse than the munchies. So if patients don't think it can be a problem, they're unlikely to mention its use. But taking time to uncover if this is a pattern for your patient and if cannabis use is involved, especially chronic use, is super important to deciding how to treat and work up your patient. Some key features that are hallmark for cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome include at least weekly use of cannabis, as well as severe and nausea and vomiting that is cyclical in nature, compulsive hot baths or showers being used to relieve symptoms, and improvement of symptoms after cessation. Another reason for getting a good history and accurate history, aside from being able to take better care of your patient, is that these patients are ripe for having multiple costly ED workups and long lengths of stay. You may have your patient tell you they've been seen multiple times and nobody can figure out what's going on. While an initial workup is going to be required at some point to exclude other diagnoses, there's always the pitfall of us not taking the time to get a full history and recognizing that patient's presentation shares hallmark features of CHS, which when recognized can help us take care of the patient more efficiently. And it wouldn't be an EM talk if I didn't mention anchoring bias, right? These patients are prime candidates for anchoring bias when there's a known history of CHS in their chart. And this can lead us to missing other significant pathologies. Upon seeing a patient with a history of CHS, you're still going to need to do your due diligence and make sure you're not missing something else, such as DKA, intestinal obstruction, or a surgical abdomen. Still make sure you do a thorough physical and listen to your patient. Patients often say that it feels like a previous episode, or they'll say, this feels really different. Please make sure that you are listening to them. But also, because these patients experience recurrent episodes of intractable nausea and vomiting, they are still at risk for the development of dehydration and other electrolyte abnormalities. Don't overlook this. So if you do need to do a workup, what is appropriate? Obviously, if anything concerning is on the exam in history, i.e. sepsis, surgical abdomen, address those first and immediately. Otherwise, a good place to start is always checking a finger stick, getting an ECG, and not just to check their QT interval, but also for any predisposing signs of an electrolyte abnormality. BMP, UA, LFTs and lipase, UPREG when appropriate, and then giving them fluids, appropriate antiemetics, plus or minus GI cocktails. So what treatments exactly do we have to treat this syndrome now that we understand a little bit more about it? Which ones work and which ones don't? So our traditional antiemetics of Zofran and Reglan While these are what we're comfortable reaching for when treating patients in the ED, if you look to the literature, we find that traditional antiemetics have proven to have very low success rates in treating cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome. There may be some aspect of reporting bias at play here. However, clinical experience also supports that CHS more often than not does not respond well to these medications. In addition, there appears to be evidence available that other agents are superior in treating the symptoms of CHS, and so we can't recommend these as first-line therapies. And while it can feel tempting to just try with these first, because it's what we know, drawbacks to this approach include delay of effective treatment and prolonged ED lengths of stay. So first up, we have Haldol. Haldol seemed to emerge in the literature as an off-label use for nausea and vomiting in multiple different GI disorders, and has shown quite a bit of promise with cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome. Recently, the HAVOC trial showed that Haldol was twice as effective as Zofran in reducing nausea and abdominal pain in CHS patients. It also showed decrease in the use of rescue medications, as well as time from medication administration to ED discharge, 3.1 hours versus 5.6 hours in the Haldol versus traditional antiemetic groups. Recommended dosing is actually gonna be weight-based, 2.5 milligrams IV or IM if they are under 80 kilograms, 5 milligrams IV if they are over. And why does it work? Still unclear. However, Haldol does have direct interaction with CB1 receptors, which may have an explanation for its efficacy. Droperidol. There's little to no case reports or studies using droperidol for CHS, but this is also likely stemming from almost no one using droperidol for the past 15 to 20 years due to a controversial black box warning restriction from 2001 in regards to QT prolongation. So of note, there has not been a single case report in which droperidol antiemetic dosing ranges have been associated with QT prolongation, dysrhythmias, or cardiac arrest. And also important to note that the black box warning that was initially given didn't apply to doses of less than 2.5 milligrams IV or IM. Important to know, droperidol is actually labeled for antiemetic use versus Haldol, which is an off-label use. And our recommended dosing is 0.625 to 2.5 milligrams IV or IM. And at 2.5 milligrams or less, you do not need to have continuous ECG monitoring. Next, we have olanzapine. While we're comfortable with using olanzapine as an alternative for treatment of the agitated patient in ED, it's not what comes to mind when treating nausea and vomiting. While there's very limited evidence to support treating nausea and vomiting specific to CHS in the literature, there is a lot of evidence in oncology literature for antiemetic use. Unlike Haldol or droperidol, olanzapine is not going to prolong the QT interval and also has a much lower incidence of extrapyramidal side effects. So this may be a reasonable substitute for Haldol or droperidol in cases of documented allergy or if the patient has a prolonged QT. Recommended dosing from the oncology literature is 5 milligrams IV or IM, but this will need continued investigation to find what the best doses would be. Then we've got benzos. Benzos, specifically lorazepam, can be considered for use, but there are no studies specific to cannabinoid hyperemesis for treatment. However, there is evidence from multiple case reports that there is some efficacy observed in the treatment of cyclic vomiting syndrome patients. And since 40 to 50% of cyclic vomiting syndrome patients are also chronic cannabis users, it seems pretty reasonable to be able to extrapolate that there may be some utility in giving lorazepam to CHS patients. And lastly, we've got capsaicin. What was hoped to be this quick and easy treatment of symptoms of CHS patients attempting to simulate the relief patients felt when they took hot showers, it hasn't panned out exactly to be as great as we had all hoped. While there is evidence to support its use, it is limited to small case series and a small RCT, which had significant limitations. The issue is that the small RCT, which showed support of capsaicin use, had a large baseline difference between placebo and capsaicin group, with the placebo group being more sick or reporting higher baseline nausea ratings than the placebo group, and this was ultimately not corrected for in analysis. So overall, the evidence is somewhat weak and it shouldn't be a first-line treatment, but it can be used as an adjunct with joint decision-making in the patient. So what about discharge medications? You've achieved some relief in the ED with one of these agents. What do we send patients home with? So far, we don't have any recommendations for home medications to discharge patients. Although there's some current studies looking at lorazepam and Zofran combination as discharge med, it seems odd to send patients home with these when that's not what we treated them with in the ER. It's reasonable to think that sending patients with an oral home med for symptomatic attacks at home is possible, given that most of the effective medications we've discussed here come in oral and even ODT formulations. However, more investigation is needed to figure out the appropriate dosing and frequency to be able to formulate generalizable recommendations for discharge. Therapies that you should avoid are opiates. They've been shown over and over again to be ineffective in the treatment of CHS and may worsen symptoms secondary to slowing of gut motility. Due to their lack of evidence of any benefit, as well as the high risk of addiction and abuse, they should be avoided in the treatment of CHS. Then we come to discharging our patient and what we need to educate our patient about. This is most likely the most important and most overlooked aspect of treating this disorder. In the ER, we love to treat and treat as much as we can, but we have to do that in an appropriate way. Good discharge instructions and appropriate anticipatory guidance regarding the patient's symptoms and their cannabis use is crucial in a patient finding relief of symptoms and not just returning to your ER over and over again. So remember when we said that THC accumulates in adipose tissue and that this was going to be important? Again, just to review, here's why. Even with the cessation of marijuana, and even when the body then goes through lipolysis, stored cannabinoids can be re-released into the system and has the potential to induce symptoms even without active cannabinoid use. So this is huge because it can play a role in the failure of our patients achieving any type of long-term cessation required. If they stop smoking or using edibles, whatever their preferred method is, for just 1 to 2 days, but then end up, you know, skipping a meal or having a period of increased stress, they can then still have symptoms from that lipolysis release that will then cause them to think, well, I haven't been using cannabis and I'm still having symptoms, so that doctor must be crazy and it can't be the cause of my symptoms, and just return to their use. You have to prepare them for the fact that it can take weeks, if not months, for certain people, depending on chronicity of use, for their symptoms to completely abate. But that cessation so far has been the only thing to show a permanent effective treatment to cannabinoid hyperemesis syndrome. So a lot of work and research is still needed to better understand the syndrome, as well as increased investigation into the agents we can use to best treat our patients. And while nothing presented here today is necessarily groundbreaking, I do hope that it's given you some better insight to your patients, removed your trigger finger from just ordering Zofran for every single vomiting patient, and helped you understand how to better educate your patients to provide them with insight to their own condition. Thank you. And if there's any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
That was awesome. Thank you so much. I think this is so important. It's become such a common thing that we're seeing. And I think maybe after Dr. Silverberg's talk, some people thought they might want to indulge a little, but now you've given them something to think about. So, so do you think, I guess one question I have, we're looking at the chat to see if we have any others, but one question I have is, do you think there's an ideal medication regimen, like where to start, what to do if, you know, like first choice, second choice, backup?
Yeah, I mean, definitely from the limited studies that have been provided, Haldol or Droperidol have definitely been proven to be safe and effective. Patients have good relief with that. Some of that does come from a sedating effect. They take a nap, they wake up feeling a little bit better. But those things have both proven to be pretty effective, shorten their length of stay. And it's also something that we potentially can look into sending patients home with. I think being able to use olanzapine as an alternative, especially when you have patients that come in with that Haldol allergy, is also really interesting and important.
Yeah, that's cool. I definitely plan to try that on our next shift together, maybe.
Yeah.
Dr. Jaramonte, do you have a question?
So when you give the droperidol or Haldol, do you usually give it with Benadryl to prevent the extrapyramidal effects? Does that have any additional benefit, you know, in these patients?
It obviously does, especially if someone's been documented to have like an additional effect, but traditionally I haven't given it with Benadryl off the bat. I usually kind of give and wait and see.
Did you come across any like misdiagnosis rates or any like published, you know, case, I guess, instances in which we've kind of assumed this to be the diagnosis and then missed something else? Is that happening a lot? Or have you like with sort of like the, you know, kind of popularization or like the increased awareness of cannabinoid hyperemesis, we tend to, it can sometimes fall into that, like you said, so the anchoring bias and wondering, are we missing other things or are we pretty good at clinically diagnosing this condition?
Yeah, usually we are pretty good at diagnosing the condition. I mean, I think most of the research has shown that the problem is we actually end up overworking these patients more often than not, instead of attributing it to this. But that's often also because we're unable to elicit from our patients that they are using cannabis. Chronically, that it's been for over a year that they've been using this, that they have some of these hallmark features. But in general, a big problem with these patients is they get multiple costly workups. They go to lots of specialists and they continue to have these symptoms and feel crappy despite all of those treatments.
Seems like a situation where heuristics is important, right? If it fits the pattern neatly, you can sort of go right for it. But you were saying before, if it's not fitting, if there's something else, or you know, at least making sure that you've thought through all the other things that can still happen to those same people, like appendicitis.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that those things often, the reason why we generally don't miss them is because those things do tend to stand out. Generally, these people have generalized abdominal pain. There's nothing very specific about it, rather than somebody with the appy or the coli that tells you, oh, it's worse with meals and it hurts right here in my right upper quadrant, or it started around the belly button and now it's my right. You know, we're usually able to pick up on the other diagnoses pretty quickly.
Does it matter like how they consume the marijuana? Like their association with smoking or with edibles, or does it seem to matter kind of across the board?
Yeah, it really doesn't matter like what method they use. And again, like the amount for each ingestion doesn't seem to play a role. It has more to do just with the potency and just the prolonged chronic use of it.
Well, thank you so much. I think this has been a great conversation. And for all of you in the audience, you're going to have a few extra minutes as we've been so timely. I want to thank all of the All NYC EM board and members and all of you who you know, have been coming to these talks and making them possible. And again, we very much look forward to having them in person. So we're going to take a break and we will be back at 11:05. So everybody feel free to hydrate, do whatever you need to do, and we'll see you at 11:05. Thanks again, Dr. Stone.
Right on time. I know you your honesty shine, shine, shine now, Lord, 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 I can shine.
Down in Tribeca, right next to De Niro, but I'll be hood forever. I'm the new Sinatra, and since I made it here, I can make it anywhere. Yeah, they love me everywhere. I used to cop in Harlem, all of my Dominicanos right there up on Broadway. Pulled me back to that McDonald's, took it to my stash spot, 560 State Street. Catch me in the kitchen like a Simmons whipping pastry. Cruising down A Street, off-white Lexus, driving so slow, but BK is from Texas. Me, I'm out that Bed-Stuy, home of that boy Biggie. Now I live on Bill. And I brought my boys with me. Say what up to Tata. Still sipping my top. Sitting courtside. Knicks and Nets give me high five. Nigga, I be spiked out. I could trip a referee. Tell by my attitude that I most definitely from. With OG at a Yankee game. Shit, I made the Yankee hat more famous than a Yankee can. You should know I bleed blue, but I ain't a crypto. But I got a gang of niggas walking with my click though. Welcome to the melting pot. Corners where we selling rock. Africa been by the shit. Home of the hip-hop. Yellow cap, gypsy cap, dollar cap, holla back. For foreigners, it ain't fair. They act like they forgot how to act. 8 million stories out there in the naked. City is a pity, half of y'all won't make it. Me, I got a plug special, and I got it made. If Jesus paying LeBron, I'm paying Dwayne Wade. Three dice CeeLo, three card Marley. Labor Day parade, rest in peace, Bob Marley. Statue of Liberty, long live the World Trade, long live the King, yo. I'm from the Empire State, that's. Blinding, girls need blinders so they could step out of bounds quick. The sidelines is lined with casualties who sip the life casually, then gradually become worse. Don't fight the apple Eve, caught up in the in crowd. Now you're in style, and in the winter gets cold, in vogue with your skin out. City of sin, it's a pity on a whim. Good girls going bad, the city's filled with them. Mommy took a bus trip, now she got a bust out. Everybody ride her, just like a bus route. Hail Mary to the city, you're a virgin.
virgin, and Jesus can't save you. Life starts when the church in. Came here for school, graduated to the highlight. Ball players, rap stars, addicted to the limelight. MDMA got you feeling like a champion. The city never sleeps, better slip you an ambient.
Soul bright, but they never know what you want to hear, baby. And I think you're about to hear it now. Milwaukee and Trenton, wonderful town. This song was introduced and made famous by the great Liza Minnelli. It was written by Fred Ebb and John Kander, orchestrated by the late Don Costa. My Goomba. Start spreading the news. I am leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes, they are longing to stray right through the very heart of it. New York, New York. I want to wake up in a city that doesn't sleep and find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap. My little town blues, they have melted away. I'm gonna make a brand new start of it in old New York, if I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. It's up to you, New York, New York. Ba ba da ba da ba 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 ba. In New York, New York, I want to wake up in a city that doesn't sleep and find that I'm number one, top of the list, head of the heap, king. It's up to you, New York, New York, New York. Thank you very much.
Streets of me. If I can make it.
All right, it's 11:05. Hopefully people are back on. That was some awesome music, Jeff. That was a really great choice of New York themed pop. Really well done. So I wanna just say again, you know, how wonderful All NYC EM is, this amazing group of New York City area educators, now including New Jersey, Long Island programs, some upper state, Westchester programs. And this really is, it's been a wonderful opportunity for me. And one of the wonderful opportunities that we have is our fellowship program. And we have three fellows who are working with us right now. I just want to let you all know and say thank you to our current fellows, Janelle Lambert from downstate Kings County, Reedy Desai from St. John's, and Brian Sumner from St. Luke's and Mount Sinai West, right? It's difficult with all these corporate names to remember all the things that people, coming from NYP Brooklyn Methodist, which is losing the Methodist, I totally understand. Anyway, that was a distraction from how great those three have been. And I wanna also welcome our three new fellows, Jennifer Kaminsky from Staten Island University Hospital, Joanne Moser from Mount Sinai, and Negar Mati from Met Harlem. So welcome. Everybody who takes part in this program gets the opportunity to learn about putting on these conferences. There have been a lot of adjusting over the last 2 years as we've had to switch to Zoom, and then we're hoping to be live again for our next conference, which we think will be either end of August or early September. So we'll get back to you all on that. I know everybody likes to know times. And well, the first half was really interesting. I thought we got some great topics covered. And we have an amazing lineup for our second half. And I'm gonna turn it over to, I wanna also say, just before I turn it over to Dr. Jara Almonte, thank you so much to Brian Gilberti, who is from Mount Sinai West. Oh, geez, I think I may have mixed up my, NYU. Sorry, because I was mixing up my two Brians, NYU and Mount Sinai West. Sorry, Brian is the person who's making this happen behind the scenes. He's the one who set up the webinar and helps us make sure all our tech is right. And he's really awesome about that. So thank you, Dr. Gilberti. And I'm gonna turn it over to you.
All right, it's a great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, who's gonna be Dr. Jenny Beck-Esme. She is the Assistant Resident Director at Mount Sinai West, a graduate of the NYU Residency in Emergency Medicine and the University of Minnesota School of Medicine, where she was a MS4 rotating when I was a resident in Minneapolis. So another Midwestern transplant, and is gonna be giving us a really important talk on the lactating patient in the ER, which is something I don't think we think about and address enough. And so we're looking forward to this. With that, Dr. Beck-Esme, please.
Thank you for that introduction. I was hoping you would bring up that we go way back to our HCMC days after Dr. Melville brought up how long she's known Dr. Silverberg. And I was like, whoa, she's not the only one. So let me share my screen. Okay. Without further ado, you are working yet another busy shift. You've taken care of a young woman. You've treated her ailments. You've diagnosed her condition. You're going to prescribe a few medications for her and send her on her way. You've answered all of her questions and you're walking away. Your hand is ready to sweep open the curtain when she says, "Oh, but doc, did I tell you I'm currently breastfeeding my 6-month-old baby? Can I even take these medications?" Your heart stops. You freeze. Your hand is still on the curtain. And the first thought that goes through your head is, "Oh my God, I have no idea. I have no idea." Because you, like most of us, had one lecture on medication safety in pregnancy and lactation back in your second year of medical school. And you couldn't possibly remember that. You could possibly remember anything that you learned from that. So you try not to panic. But then you breathe a sigh of relief. Oh, you think, it's okay. I've got an ED pharmacist. I'll just ask her. But then you realize it's Saturday. And while you work in a 24/7, 365 department, this one crucial member of your team seems to only work business hours. So now you're back to panic because you don't know what to tell her. And while you stand there, frozen with your hand on the curtain, thinking about how another four patients were likely triaged to your team while you were in this room, you think, I don't know. I don't know. So you turn back to her dejected. Honestly, lady, I just don't know. You should probably pump and dump to be safe. Out of an abundance of caution, we always just revert back to you should pump and dump. But I'm going to argue that that's probably not the best strategy. So pumping and dumping is when a woman will express breast milk and discard it rather than feeding it to her infant or continuing to just directly feed her baby. When faced with confusion about medication safety and out of an abundance of caution, we often just advise a pump and dump strategy. Unfortunately, we're probably doing this far, far more often than is necessary. By the end of this talk, I want you to understand that a pump and dump strategy is harmful to our patients, and I'd like to give you the resources you need to better care for your lactating patients. So the amount of drug that's going to diffuse into the milk depends on many factors. Lipid-soluble and non-ionic substances diffuse more readily, and highly protein-bound substances diffuse less. Now, whether a substance is concentrated in maternal milk or not, the neonate generally is able to detoxify most things with no adverse effects. And there's only a few drugs that actually pose serious danger to breastfeeding infants. In general, we need to avoid interruption of breastfeeding and resorting to the strategy only in rare situations where we know a drug is going to certainly be toxic, or of course, when the mother is in critical condition. And I say this because according to the CDC, we all should be doing a better job advocating for breastfeeding. Infants who are breastfed have reduced risks, we think, of asthma, obesity, type 2 diabetes, ear and respiratory infections, and sudden infant death syndrome. Breastfeeding can also help lower the mother's risk of hypertension, type 2 diabetes, and ovarian and breast cancers. And according to the latest available data from the CDC, among US infants born in 2017, 4 out of 5 of them started out breastfeeding. And this high percentage suggests that mothers probably want to breastfeed and are trying to do it. But by 12 months, only 1/3 of these babies were still breastfeeding. Now, given that the World Health Organization and UNICEF recommend exclusive breastfeeding for the first 6 months of life, and then the introduction of age-appropriate foods alongside continued breastfeeding for up to 2 years, this isn't great. So I'm going to briefly take us through some of the medications that are deemed safe for breastfeeding in the major categories that we need them in the emergency department. But obviously, I'm not actually expecting you to memorize these based on this one lecture. The thing that I really need you to know, as with a lot of what we do, is how to quickly and easily find this information on the job. So if you stop listening after I say these next few slides, that's fine. This is what you need to know. I have a couple of tools for you. The first is LactMed. This is a searchable database on your computer. Go to the internet, you'll find it. It's provided by the National Institutes of Health, and it summarizes safety of medications in breastfeeding and the effects of these medications on lactation. So not only are they safe for baby, but are they going to alter mom's milk supply? The second, and the one that I generally use the most, is called Infant Risk. And this has kind of two options. The first is a phone line that either clinicians or patients can call during business hours to inquire about specific medications. So you just ask an expert and they'll tell you. There's also a relatively cheap mobile app that is super, super easy to use that gives data for both pregnancy and lactation. And I would recommend that you take a look at that. So now there is one category of medications. If I had to pick one that I think you have to know cold in emergency medicine and you never really have time to look up, and that is going to be, of course, the medications you need for RSI. The good news is that most of the medications that you're gonna need for RSI are perfectly safe for the breastfeeding mother. Now, what about ketamine? When it comes to ketamine, we don't really have great data. The little data that we do have suggests the units of ketamine in nursing mothers may not affect the infant at all, but we don't really know. So for now, the suggestion is that we use alternative agents, but I'm gonna say this as our kind of EM caveat. This is probably more applicable to the anesthesiologist who's performing an intubation for some version of an elective procedure. If you're intubating a mother in the emergency department who you're probably doing it to save her life. And so of course, breastfeeding is going to be a secondary issue in that case. So use what you know. If you feel like it has to be ketamine, it has to be ketamine, and you can deal with the problems afterwards. The next most important thing I want to tell you is not really a time sensitive one, but it's one that we do so routinely that I don't want you to have to look it up each and every time. And that is that both IV contrast and gadolinium are perfectly safe. Let me repeat this, because without a doubt, you're going to have a patient who's told the opposite by a well-meaning radiologist or radiology tech. Both iodinated contrast and gadolinium are fine, fine, fine. Now I'm going to blow through the next couple of categories, not so that you memorize the meds, but to prove my point. More often than not, we can probably just let our nursing mothers nurse. All of these antibiotics, perfectly safe. Antiemetics, go for it. Pain medications, absolutely. Opiates can even be given, provided the infant can be monitored for any signs of CNS depression. So treat these mothers' pain. Anxiolytics for that anxious new mom, yep, yep, yep. And even some commonly used anticoagulants are absolutely no problem. Now, there is one last category that we see in the emergency department that I think bears a little bit of discussion, and that's post-exposure prophylaxis. As we know, HIV can be transmitted from the mother to the infant via breast milk. A nursing mother who sustains a needle stick will, of course, be petrified at the notion of both seroconverting herself and of exposing her child. Because of this, many providers, myself included, assume that a nursing mother starting PEP for a needle stick must discontinue breastfeeding altogether. But this can be devastating for both a mom and an infant. Luckily, UCSF runs the National Clinician Consultation Center, which can give rapid expert guidance in managing healthcare worker and layperson exposures to HIV, as well as Hep B and Hep C. Think of it kind of like your poison center for PEP. So I called them a few weeks ago for a patient in this scenario, and here's what I learned. First, the risk of HIV transmission from a needle stick is actually very low. If the needle is freshly stuck from a patient who is known to have HIV and then into the provider, the risk of transmission is only actually about 0.23%. And that transmission risk decreases the longer the needle has been out of the patient. So by the time a needle has been out of a patient for 24 hours, say one that's kind of at the bottom of a Sharps container that spills, there's zero transmission risk. Second, by adding PEP, we take that already low risk of transmission and reduce it by another 80% or so, making the risk of the patient seroconverting exceedingly low. So because of this, there's actually not been a patient to provider HIV transmission in 20 years. All that being said, the risk of seroconversion for mom is obviously not zero, and an acute HIV infection in mother would actually significantly increase the risk of HIV to the breastfeeding infant. So now how about the medications, the PEP medications? There's limited data on these medications in breast milk. Many of them are detectable in breast milk, but may not actually be detectable in the infant in any significant amount. In general, a combination of either tenofovir and ritalgravir, which I believe is my hospital's combination, or tenofovir and dolutegravir are the recommended combinations. These are the preferred agents actually in HIV positive pregnant women. So if they're deemed safe for the fetus, they're probably thought to be safe for the infant as well. So given the low risk of seroconversion and the generally thought to be low risk of medication harm, the patient has a few options and she and her family are gonna have to weigh those along with you. She can decline PEP and continue to breastfeed as usual, knowing her risk of seroconversion is around 0.23% from a fresh stick. She can take PEP and continue to breastfeed as usual, knowing that her risk of seroconversion is exceedingly low at that point and the medications are likely safe for her infant. Or she can take PEP and pump and freeze her milk until a negative fourth generation HIV antibody and antigen test is done at 4 weeks. If her primary concern is actually the HIV transmission, and then she could go ahead and use that milk. Or she could pump and dump the milk if her primary concern is the infant's medication exposure, and then if she's still pumping, she'll still be making milk and she can get that negative test at 4 weeks and resume breastfeeding. If you need help counseling the patient on any of these or deciding for your patient's specific circumstances, call that hotline. They are incredibly helpful. So medication safety is usually the first thing that comes to our mind when we're thinking about caring for the lactating patient, but it's by no means the only aspect of their care that we need to consider. We often think and remember to ask our patients if they could be pregnant, but I don't think we really often remember to ask if they're breastfeeding. So ask your patient if they're breastfeeding. If they are, you might need to make some adjustments to their care in the ED, as well as the medications you might give them, and they might not think to tell you. So just make it routine. For any woman who's of the appropriate age, just say, are you pregnant or breastfeeding? Practice it with me. Are you pregnant or breastfeeding? It should be just as routine as any other of the questions that we ask. If she is breastfeeding, she's going to need to nurse or pump every 3 to 4 hours, both to maintain her milk supply and for her own comfort. So assist your patient with a breast pump if she's in the emergency department for longer than 3 hours, or if you're planning on admitting her. And then, of course, if she is pumping and planning to keep that milk, she's going to need a place to keep her milk cold. Breast milk can safely be kept at room temperature for up to 4 hours, but as we know, in most of our departments, she's probably going to be there for a lot longer. Storage is probably going to take some creativity, as the best place for it is probably not in the patient fridge alongside the turkey sandwiches. Make sure you put a patient's label on her milk containers, maybe call up to your OB floor for their assistance. They probably have a fridge if they keep their patient's milk in, and enlist the help of your charge nurse if you need to. Last resort, a bucket of ice, but you might have to help your patient with this. So to summarize, your go-to intubation medications are a go. Don't worry about it, save mom's life. Your contrast materials are perfectly safe. I'm gonna repeat this again, because your patient is gonna have been told wrong. These are fine, go ahead and order these scans. Your lactating patient is gonna need to pump every 3 to 4 hours and chill that milk. So do what you can to help facilitate this process. It's good both for her milk supply and for her comfort, both physically and mentally. Remember, the majority of the medications that we give in the emergency department are gonna be perfectly safe. So far too often we're recommending a pump and dump strategy. Lauren Westifer from the Foamcast podcast and blog created this really, really fabulous quick reference table that I recommend you just save on your phone, or at least remember to Google on shift if you have a quick question. And then when in doubt, use these resources. LactMed has a website that's searchable online. Infant Risk has an 800 number, as well as an app on your phone. And the UCSF hotline, PEP hotline, is open 7 days a week and are incredibly, incredibly helpful. A knee-jerk pump and jump strategy for our patients is just bad. It's bad for our patients and it's bad for our families. And with just a little bit of extra effort, we can all do a lot better. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Dr. Beck asked me, that was really awesome. Nice, quick, extraordinarily helpful information. I have to tell you, since the last time we talked, I downloaded LactMed and I keep it and use it all the time. So common, the CAT scan issue, right? I hear it all the time. I'm sure I've told many a patient that I apologize to now that they had to pump and dump. And one of the questions I get sometimes is it that the contrast is safe for the baby, but gets into the breast milk, or it doesn't get into the breast milk at all? How can I tell the mom?
I don't know the specifics for that question with IV contrast, but it's gonna depend on each medication, whether it actually concentrates in the milk enough to get to the baby, or whether it doesn't even get into the milk, or whether it gets in the milk and gets into the baby, but in a way that is not harmful. So I'd have to, if the patient actually posed that question to me, I'd probably have to look specifically on LactMed to see if it told me. But I have been told, I have had patients that come in with this. I actually, just the other day, I had a patient who came in from this. She went for an outpatient CAT scan for a obstetric complication, like an abscess from her C-section scar. And she was told then, she was just a few weeks postpartum, and she was told then she had to pump and dump. So by the time she came to me, 12 hours later, when her findings had been read as an outpatient, she'd already started her baby on formula because she thought she couldn't feed them. So it was really disappointing to see that she had been given that misinformation. So spread the word, CAT scans, MRIs, fine.
If we think about it, we would give the baby the contrast if we needed to, right?
We would, exactly. And same thing with most of these medications, right? The antibiotics, all these things we would give the baby if we needed to. So,
right.
And they're getting a far smaller concentration of things that are in the milk. So even things like alcohol that women are often told that they can't have when they're breastfeeding, the concentration that actually gets into the milk is a fraction of what mom has. So what's actually getting to baby is almost negligible.
Interesting.
Are there any meds we like absolutely have to be aware of or know about, the things we use commonly that are definite no-nos just to have in the list, sort of the no list?
The no list mostly just includes the ketamine, but let me just put this slide back up because there's a few things on the in the red column that we can just all take a look at together. Oops. Okay, from current slide. I'm gonna share my screen. So on the red column there, these are things that you should probably, some of them you should probably be avoiding anyway. Codeine and tramadol really have very little clinical utility, like ever. Tramadol is so erratic in adults. It's obviously going to be erratic in babies. So just avoid those. Diphenhydramine, you know, plus minus, if you had to give it, I probably would, but you're going to want to try and avoid it. And sudafedrin as well. Those are the ones that you want to definitely avoid. And then ketamine is kind of on the edge. If you feel like you need it, it's probably okay, but the data is not really there to support using it yet.
Yeah, pseudoephedrine is one we try to avoid giving to the kids as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
Makes a lot of sense. All right, well, thank you so much. That was awesome. And our next speaker is the wonderful Dr. Swaminathan, not Swaminathan, who is coming to us from St. Joe's in Jersey. And he is an assistant professor of emergency medicine there and world famous and he's world famous for MRAP, of course. So without further ado, I'm gonna turn it over to Dr. Swaminathan.
Thanks for the introduction. It's great to be here with you guys. I love being able to go in the afternoon, so we get the shorter time slots, a little bit less that I have to actually prepare, which is always good. But this is a topic that scares me a little bit. And I think it scared me since residency when I had my first patient who had a postpartum hemorrhage. And I remember kind of reeling around thinking, I have no idea what I'm doing. And I felt that way for a while, continued to feel that way. And eventually, at some point, I realized that I couldn't go to shift being scared of a presentation, even as rare as this actually happens. I've handled maybe half a dozen over the last 10 years or so. It's not that common, but I couldn't go to a shift scared of it. And I remember one of my mentors, Rich Levitan, teaching me that when there's something that scares you, what you need to do is run at it, not away from it, because we can't avoid these things in emergency medicine. The more we are afraid of it, the more likely it is that we are the ones who have to deal with it. And so we have to be really good at these things. And postpartum hemorrhage, I think, is one of these that kind of scares people because of the rarity and, of course, because of the dangers that are inherent here. So step one, probably the most important thing is to recognize that you're dealing with postpartum hemorrhage. Obviously, we can't even start to treat the disease or talk about how to treat the disease until we know that that's actually what we are taking care of. And unfortunately, women with postpartum hemorrhage are not going to present with hemodynamic instability every time. They're not always going to be tachycardic and tachypneic and hypotensive, because young women hold on to their vital signs until they don't. And so we need to be a little bit more prepared to recognize this than just waiting for tachycardia and hypotension to develop. If you look at the OB literature, it says that postpartum hemorrhage is anything where there is more than 500 cc's of bleeding after delivery. That sounds great, except that when we are having deliveries in the emergency department, the blood is on the floor, it's in the ambulance, it's on the bed sheets, and understanding whether you're actually dealing with 500 cc's or not can be challenging. And so what I would say is, if there's more bleeding than you would expect after a delivery, call it postpartum hemorrhage and start moving forward with that algorithm. And I think that will be the best way to keep you and your patients safe, is to have that in mind. So if it's more bleeding than you would expect, call it postpartum hemorrhage and start working down that algorithm. Now, there's a number of things we're going to be doing, and I'm going to talk about them in series, but actually we're doing this in parallel. And the first thing you want to do is get on the phone with your OB colleagues, because you're going to need their help. In fact, not just OB, you're going to want your NICU, right? You want someone to come down and take care of the baby. Or if you have a pediatric ED, just grab the pediatrician and say, come take care of the baby. Take that one off of my plate. I don't want to deal with that patient. I'm going to focus on the mom with the postpartum hemorrhage. That is going to be your focus. So call OB and get them down. Now, what if you work somewhere without OB, as many of us do? Well, then what you want is your surgeon. In a pinch, a surgeon can do all of the necessary things here that an OB can. And so if you work in a remote place where you don't have OB, go ahead and call surgery. Many of these patients will end up needing to go to the operating room. And so again, if you don't have an OB to operate, a surgeon can be extremely helpful. IR is another service that you might want to use. Depending on the kind of bleeding, they might be very helpful as well, a less invasive approach. But ultimately, you will need a surgeon. You want a surgeon on board to make that decision. So OB, if you got it. If not, it's your general surgeon. And if you have none of those services available, you're going to have to be looking at a transfer early. So make sure that you are getting on the phone and arranging for that transfer to happen. Again, you want to transfer them somewhere where they actually can get the services that they need. So if you are transferring and you have a possible close enough with a surgeon, great. Even better is if you have OB. I'm not really sure what's happening with my slides right now, so I apologize, but I'm going to try and fix it. So now you've made those consult calls, and now what you want to do is start with your initial resuscitation. And I think we're pretty good at initial resuscitation. We're good at popping two lines in, giving supplemental oxygen. And then what's the next thing we do? We go ahead and we hang some fluids. But a postpartum hemorrhage is very similar to a trauma patient. And so we want to limit our use of crystalloid as much as possible. The patient's not bleeding normal saline or lactated ringers or plasma light for that matter. And so what we should be doing is giving them back blood. So activate your transfusion protocol, get blood into this person. And we can talk about when to activate massive transfusion, et cetera, but we're going to leave that out for a minute. And what we're still going to do is just say, give blood. And when you're giving blood, what you want to shoot for is a 1:1:1 transfusion. Now, there is some literature emerging that maybe we don't have to give platelets in the same ratio. Maybe 2:1:1 is okay. Maybe 3:4 is okay. Just shoot for a ratio that is accepted. Whatever you're shooting for in trauma, same ratio that you're going to shoot for here. Now, of course, if we're talking trauma, we always talk about tranexamic acid. We know the literature for tranexamic acid is very good in trauma. It's slightly weaker in postpartum hemorrhage. The woman trial, which came out just a couple of years ago, tells us that there may be a benefit. It's not a huge benefit, though. It's not a mortality benefit like we saw in trauma or we see in trauma. And so what I would say is, if you know what your local practice pattern is, if you have OB in-house and typically they like to give tranexamic acid postpartum hemorrhage, then go ahead and give it. If they tend not to give it, don't give it. If they don't weigh in either way, then you can make a choice. I tend to use it. And when I say tend to use it, we're talking about in the half dozen cases that I've seen, I give tranexamic acid mainly because that's what my consulting services prefer. So we go ahead and give the tranexamic acid. While we're talking about massive hemorrhage, another thing we have to really think about is warmth, is keeping the patient warm. If the patient even drops a degree or two, that's massively going to affect their ability to clot. And there's good literature in the trauma sphere that tells us when temperatures drop even a degree or two, we do see increased need for transfusion. So keep the patient warm. Probably move them away from the door where they're coming in from the ambulance bay. That is obviously the coldest spot in the ED. Anything you can do to warm them, a forced air is probably the best, but keep the patient warm. And as you are transfusing, don't forget about calcium. I think we often forget about the role of calcium here. These patients are going to become hypocalcemic, and the risk of giving calcium without a calcium level is extremely low. I would say after you've given 3 units of blood, you're going to give calcium, and then for every 3 units after that, go ahead and give calcium. 2 amps of gluconate or 1 gram of calcium chloride, whichever one you got lying around is totally fine. But the idea is once you're giving more than 2 units, go ahead and start supplementing calcium as well. Now, what we've done at this point is our initial resuscitation, and this is where we need to take a cognitive pause. We need to take a cognitive pause and say, what's causing the postpartum hemorrhage? Because that's going to address the rest of our management. And when we think about the causes of postpartum hemorrhage, we really focus on 4 T's. There are 4 T's, 4 different causes we have to be focused on. The first of these is tissue. So this is retained products most of the time. And after that delivery, if the placenta hasn't been delivered, deliver the placenta. That is a major source of bleeding. And then look at the placenta and see, is it intact? If there are bits of the placenta missing, then those are what's causing continued bleeding, or they're at least part of the continued bleeding. And so what you're gonna have to do is place your hand into the uterus, and you're actually gonna have to scrape against the wall of the uterus with your hand to remove the rest of that placenta. So this is really important. Deliver the placenta, look at the placenta, make sure it's intact. If it's not, then retained products are going to be one of the possible causes, and you're gonna have to remove that tissue. All right, T number two is trauma. There are a couple of different ones under the trauma heading. The first is uterine inversion. And in general, you're not gonna miss this. The uterus has become prolapsed. It is not where it is supposed to be. And because it's not where it's supposed to be, it can't do that tighten up all those blood vessels. And so it's gonna continue to ooze and bleed. And so it's gonna have to be replaced. And then you're gonna have to do some uterine massage, which we're gonna come back to in a minute. This replacement of the uterus that's prolapsed can be kind of difficult. In the books that I have read, because I've never had one of these cases, and by talking to my OB colleagues, they tell me they usually will take the patient to the OR for this. So if a patient delivers outside the OR, they have a uterine inversion, they're going to the OR to have this fixed because it can be difficult to reduce. It can be very painful. In a pinch, when you are in the emergency department and you can't just whisk the patient away to the OR, I would probably use a little bit of ketamine for a little bit of analgesia and sedation in order to make this happen. If you happen to work someplace with nitrous like I do, you could probably use nitrous too, but you're gonna have to give something for that analgesia and sedation. Number two under the trauma heading is lacerations. And these lacerations won't always be obvious. So you're gonna have to get good suction, good lighting so you can see it. And while it would be ideal once you identify a laceration to just throw a couple of stitches and sew it up, I'm not particularly good at sewing lacerations inside a vagina. It's not something that I do very often. And so direct pressure is probably going to be your best bet unless you have a particular skill set here. All right, T number three is tone. And it's the third one that we get to, but it's actually the most common. So this is uterine atony. And this is why you often see after there's a delivery, what's the first thing that happens? Some nurse starts massaging the uterus. And that massaging the uterus gets it to tighten up and to stop continued bleeding. So this is something that commonly is done on the OB floors, but maybe we forget to do it. I find that the person in the emergency department, the deliveries I've been at that starts doing that is usually the charge nurse, because your charge nurse is usually your most experienced nurse, has worked everywhere in the hospital, and all of a sudden, as soon as that baby comes out, just starts massaging the uterus. It's almost like some kind of a Pavlovian response that they have to do it. That's how it is on the OB floors, and we kind of have to have the same approach. So we want to start by doing massage, and we can do that with bimanual external massage. That's our first step. But often that's not going to be enough in postpartum hemorrhage. And you're going to have to proceed to internal external massage. And what you have here is you have one hand that is inside the vagina pressing up against the uterus, and the other hand is pushing down. And you're squeezing the uterus between those two hands in order, again, to get that tone back. And while you're doing that, you don't want to wait. This isn't like I'm going to do uterine massage for 10 minutes, see if it works, then move on to the next steps. It really is while you're doing your uterine massage, you're going to start calling for medications. And the problem is that the most common medications don't live in your department, and we almost never use them, so we're not familiar with them. It would be great if we just say, we're just gonna stock them. But I can't remember the last time I called for these medications, so maybe that's not a good use. So as soon as you know you have a postpartum hemorrhage, send somebody to pharmacy to start getting medications. And the ones that you wanna get immediately are oxytocin and methergine. These are the most common ones that OB will reach for in postpartum hemorrhage. There's also carbaprost and Hemabate. These are the other medications, but oxytocin and methergine are your kind of go-tos. Not gonna remember your dosages, so just have some place that you can look it up. And you don't have to start these in series. You can just start them both at the same time. And again, if you're dealing with a postpartum hemorrhage, hopefully you've got some help by this point, but if you don't, just go ahead and throw both medications on. It's the best way to make sure that we are getting control of that bleeding. Next thing to think about is, can I create some kind of a direct pressure on the uterus in order to stop that bleeding? So I'm doing my bimanual massage, I'm getting those medications in, but can I do something else? And some people talk about packing the uterus, but remember, this is a boggy, non-contracted uterus. It's gonna take a lot of gauze to go into that uterus to provide any level of tamponade. And so what would be a much better approach is to use something called I'm blanking on the name of this device. It's a balloon tamponade system. It's gonna come to me in about a minute or so, but you wanna see if you can get a Bakri balloon. So you wanna see if you can get one of these to place into the uterus. And it works sort of like a Blakemore tube. We pass this device through the cervix, we inflate the balloon, it creates direct tamponade on the bleeding area. So this is the ideal. But again, you have to know, do I have Bakri balloons in the hospital? And do I have Bakri balloons in my emergency department? I would argue that if you have OB in-house, maybe you don't need to stock these in your emergency department. But if you don't have OB in-house, you definitely should be stocking these in your ER. And even better would just be all of us stock one and know where it is. Somewhere in the resuscitation area is probably the best place. Now, there's some studies looking at, can I use something else? If I don't have a Bakri balloon, could I use a Foley catheter or a Blakemore tube? And the answer is no. The Foley catheter balloon is way too small. What will happen is you pass that Foley, you inflate the balloon, and you will think that you have controlled the bleeding. What you've actually done is hidden the bleeding. And I've seen this a number of times in patients transferred from other hospitals who are like, oh, we put a Foley catheter up and there's no more bleeding. And as soon as you take that the balloon down, there's like a liter of blood behind it. So Foley catheter is not going to work. Blakemore tube is not going to work. But if you see all the way on the right side, is something that may work. And this is actually a condom placed on a Foley catheter and then inflated. And there's a couple of papers looking at this in low resource environments. And basically they found that the condom will accept enough air to actually be able to create a balloon tamponade. So if you don't have a Bakri balloon, but you got that little fishbowl by the charge nurse's desk of condoms, that might be your go-to here. So you put the condom on the end of the Foley catheter, you slide that Foley catheter through the cervix, you inflate the condom just the same way as you would do with a Bakri balloon. All right, our final T is thrombin, which makes us remember about DIC. If the patient is still bleeding at this point, where you have done all of these different steps, then you have to think about the fact that maybe this patient has a coagulopathy. And DIC is a common end game in postpartum hemorrhage. Ideally, we'd have a bunch of labs telling us we have DIC, but that's not realistic. And what I would say to do instead is just look at the places you put an IV in. And if they are oozing, then DIC is on the table and we need to start treating it. Unfortunately, the best way to treat DIC is to remove the inciting issue, which means that the patient's going to need to go to the OR for hysterectomy. And this is why you want your surgeons on board early. You don't want to call your surgeon after you've done everything and you're like, oh crap, patient's still bleeding, they have DIC. What you'd rather do is get them on board early to make that decision, are we going to the OR for hysterectomy or not? All right, let's recap really quickly, just three things that we have to remember when we're dealing with the patient with postpartum hemorrhage. First is to recognize, if it's more bleeding than you expect, call it postpartum hemorrhage and move forward with your algorithm. Number two is to start resuscitation. Two large bore IVs, give them blood, keep the normal saline, the lactated ringers on the shelf if possible, consider tranexamic acid. Don't forget calcium once you cross the 3-unit threshold. And then finally, review those four T's, trauma, thrombin, tone, and tissue. And those are going to be the most common causes of postpartum hemorrhage. If you go through that methodically, I don't think this is a very worrisome diagnosis. It isn't one that we should be scared of. It's one that we should really be prepared to take care of. And that's all I've got. And I'd be happy, of course, to answer any questions.
Thanks so much, Sonny. That was a really great talk and really important topic that I think we can all, you know, we don't obviously see a ton of in the academic centers where all of our delivering patients get swept upstairs so rapidly. But if you're out in your own, you know, anywhere in the where you don't have that immediate availability of OB consultation, we should be prepared to do that and take care of. Curious about how do you keep any like medications in the ER? Are they in the Pyxis? Do you have Pitocin down there? Do you have Methogen? Or where are you getting them from if you have to give them?
I think most commonly they're not going to be there. It's the honest truth is that we just don't use these medications enough to justify the little bit of real estate we have. And, you know, I work in New Jersey in a very large hospital. The footprint of my ED is larger than almost everybody else's on this call. Your guys are going to be even tighter on what you can keep down there. So I don't think we're going to. And it's why I think it's really important to pick somebody and send them to pharmacy as soon as you recognize that that's what you're dealing with. And just tell them, get me oxytocin, get me Methogen, get me Hemabate, get me Carbaprost. Get me all four of those medications. And once you get down here, we'll figure out what to give. But just go and get them, because you guys know, when you need something that is not stocked in your ED, getting them from pharmacy is going to be way too long. So just send somebody immediately to do it.
A great idea. Back to the recognition idea. Is there any way you keep track of sort of how much blood loss or sort of, you know, recognize, like, is there a system or are people, you know, counting towels or counting pads or weighing clot? How do you actually sort of physically keep track of how much blood is been lost to recognize, like, okay, we're really dealing with a postpartum hemorrhage. If you're not used to sort of qualitatively saying, like, that seems like a lot.
I think it's a good question. You know, if we think about where most people are delivering upstairs in L&D, it's probably similar to our situation where it's not like somebody is continually suctioning all of the blood to know exactly how much is there. And so I think a lot of times it is a gut call to say, I think that's more blood than I would expect. I'm definitely not going to advocate for weighing towels and stuff like that and bed sheets. I just don't think it's going to work. I really think you just have to look at it and say, you know, I have not delivered as many babies as most OBs, I think. But you have to look at it and be like, from my experience of delivering kids, that's too much blood. That's more than I would expect. And I think you go with it. If you think about it in general, with the exception of the initial rush of fluid, there's really not that much bleeding in a vaginal delivery. In a standard vaginal delivery, there's not that much bleeding. So if it's anything more than you're comfortable with and it's ongoing, then I would go ahead and call it. And of course, this is not going to be like an arterial bleed shooting in your face. This is going to be slow ooze. So you really need to keep paying attention to it. The ones that I've seen missed or at least delay in diagnosis, it's usually because everyone's so focused on the baby that they forget that there is actually a primary patient, the mom, that we also have to be taking care of.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. Is, you know, just sort of slow over time, and that clinical recognition is important. So thank you so much for talking a really important topic.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Will you just say the name of that balloon one more time? Because I think a lot of us were like, okay, wait, what is that again?
It's amazing because I got notes where it's supposed to say that. It's called a Bakri balloon, B-A-K-R-I, Bakri.
Got it.
And what I find is that if you call OB and tell me you have a postpartum hemorrhage, most of the time they'll bring the balloon with them. But I have found times where they don't, and they have sent somebody scrambling for one. So I just, when I call them, I say, I've got a postpartum hemorrhage. I don't have a Bakri balloon. Can you bring one down? But most hospitals with OB, if not all of them, will have one because it's a magical device. A couple $100 and these really can stop bleeding very, very quickly. And one thing I didn't mention that I think is important is, even though we don't see postpartum hemorrhage a lot, this also applies for post-abortion hemorrhage. It's the same management for post-abortion hemorrhage. And we used to see those patients all the time rolling into the department where you get the call from clinic like, oh, you know, this patient, you know, we did a medical abortion or a surgical abortion in the clinic and they're bleeding heavily and we're sending them to your emergency department. It's the exact same algorithm. Call OB, call surgery, and then do everything else just like we talked about.
That's super important, especially given who knows what we're going to start seeing in the future. Great. Thank you so much. And that one little moment where you forgot the name of that balloon, I think is really helpful for everyone in the world to know who's watching that someone you're in your MRAP jacket in your studio. And even you can sometimes have a moment, you know, and you go on and it was a fantastic talk. So
I've already called 911. I think it was a stroke and I pushed my own TPA. So I'm good. Thanks,
guys. I would be surprised if you're pushing TPA. All right. Next and finally and wonderfully, our next speaker is Dr. Frasso Ademekos. She is the Vice Chair of Education at Metropolitan Harlem Emergency Medicine Residency and the NYMC School of Medicine and is on the Board of Directors for all NYCEM, as so many of our other speakers have been as well. She lectures frequently nationally on various lecture topics and specializes in code management and diversity and equity in medicine. Dr. Ademekos would also like us to know that she is a proud wife and mother of twins and a toddler who keeps her busy outside of work. And today she is going to talk to us about moving past ACLS in PEA management.
All right, thank you for the introduction, Laura. So it turns out, despite our previous trial, I cannot share my screen. So would you be able to maybe share my PowerPoint? I think I'd send it to you. Sorry, everyone. We did a trial run this morning. It's just one of those days.
No.
Yes. Hang on. Yes. I'm going to pull it up. It's going to take me a few minutes. So then.
Thanks, everyone. I could send it to you again. Hold on.
Try sharing now for us. You got to be able to.
Sorry?
Try sharing now.
No, it's not you. It's not you. It's me.
Okay, I'm opening the slide. I have it in Google Slides. Is that going to be okay?
Can you download it?
It's opening.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So now I I think I did download it, but of course, right now. Okay. You want to resend it? Why don't you resend it to me also, if you can? Sorry.
I did
actually download it, but now it says keep. Oh, here we go. Okay, I have it signed. And then I'm going to, oh gosh, it keeps telling
me. Yeah, I'm going to share it with you.
Okay.
Just give me one sec. Go play some music while we do this. Great way to end the day.
Sorry, guys. Again, tech things do happen.
810 trial run. What was that for? That's all right. Well, I'm excited to be here with everyone, and I'm definitely excited. I feel honored to be at the end of the day going after Jenny and Swami. I don't know why that was chosen, but here we are. Okay. So I'm going to send it to you now, Laura. Laura or Josh?
Send it to me.
Send it both.
Okay. Sent.
Problem I'm having is I go to open it and then it. A problem, Jeff. If you'll try as well, because it's sending me a little bit in circles as I'm trying to open it. I did already.
I could also do it without the slides, but if that's always an option, just so you guys know.
Let's see. We can.
Got it.
I'm at it. I have it, but it's not giving me. Okay, I'm at make a copy.
All right. So how about if we can't open it, how about we do this? So how about we talk? I'm going to give the talk and for the panelists that are up here with me. Oh, there we go. We can make it. All right. So this is me. Thanks everyone for your patience. I'm Dr. François Damakis. I'm the Vice Chair of Education at the Metropolitan Harlem Emergency Medicine Residency. Next, I'm just going to say next for everyone. So the lecture that I'm going to be giving is Beyond ACLS, Management of PEA Arrests. It's definitely a topic that I really enjoy. Next. So for those of you who still have a red phone, imagine that you're working a clinical shift. You're in the trauma bay, the critical care bay, and you get a notification. Next. You get a call that you have a patient coming in, there's CPR in progress, they roll in and CPR is going on. Next. So patient is in PEA arrest. So that means that you see an organized rhythm on the monitor, but there is no palpable pulse. Next. What do we typically do for PEA management? We give some medication, maybe you'll give some calcium, maybe you'll give some epinephrine. You're not always 100% sure why or what you're giving. Next. You're going to check a pulse. You're going to find a pulse. You're going to try to find a pulse. Is there a pulse? Is there not a pulse? Next. And then the main thing that we're doing for PEA arrest, right, is going through your H's and T's. And I don't know about you, but I don't find these terribly helpful all the time. I find sometimes, next, I'm left scratching my head going, what else can I do for this patient? And I feel really frustrated, honestly, managing PEA patients. Next. So I'd like us to take a pause here and think about a different way that we can do this. And this is not something that I'm just making up out of my own head. There's a lot of people out there who are feeling the same thing that I am and thinking that we should be managing PEA arrest in a better fashion. Next. So we're going to be moving away from the H's and T's. Next. And we're going to talk about a new approach. Next. And the reason is that it's our patients' lives at stake. A lot of the patients who come in PEA arrest are some of them are young, they have families, they have really important lives that we want to get them back and running to. And if we just go through the regular algorithm, we know that PEA arrest has poor outcomes. It leaves us all, like I said, thinking, what could we be doing better to take care of these patients? Next. At the end of the day, we're physicians. We used to be called healthcare heroes. I haven't heard that around in a long time, but we can do better than just following a simple algorithm. We're emergency medicine physicians. This is our specialty, and we should be doing better by our patients. Next. So the goal of this lecture, the goals of this lecture is very simple. Next. I'd like you to continue using ACLS because that is standard of care, but instead of just taking one road and kind of following down it and going down and not thinking about what you're doing or why you're doing, I'm going to propose some different things. Next. So if you're going to take one thing away from my lecture, it's going to be this slide. You can take a picture of it. If you're someone who's visual, I'm going to go over and repeat this a bunch of times. But your first pulse checks, you should be using the linear probe to help you find the pulse. The second pulse check that you do, you should be using the cardiac probe to look at cardiac activity. We're going to go into all of this. And at your third pulse check, once you have your team organized and everything is flowing and you've done these things, you should be using your brain to actually try to figure out why this patient is in PEA arrest. Next. So first pulse check, what we should be doing to find our pulse is use the linear probe to help us. And I'm sure some of you out there are thinking, why in the world am I proposing this? Next. So I'm not making this up. There's actually literature out there to support this. And there are people who have been implementing this in their standard of care. So the reason you wanted to use the linear probe for pulse check is that it actually saves you 6 seconds in terms of finding the pulse. And if you think about it, a lot of our patients, it's really hard to find a pulse. They have lots of subcutaneous tissue. You're feeling around and you can't find it. I cannot be the only person who has had trouble knowing if our patient has a pulse or not. So using the linear probe bypasses all of that trouble and it saves you 6 seconds. Next. It's easy to do. You don't have to be ultrasound trained. If you can do an ultrasound guided line, you can definitely find the look at the carotid and see if there is a pulse. Next. You could do fancier things if you were really unsure, but that view that we had just before is going to be sufficient for you to know if your patient actually has a pulse, or if you're just feeling around and you can't find it because you have I love my interns, but you know, if you haven't checked a pulse, you might not know what's going on. So using the linear probe will help you accurately find a pulse. Next. And then the next thing is what you can do after that, once you found a pulse, let's say there is no pulse and you're continuing on in your CPR, your ACLS algorithm, someone can put a pen or you can just visually now everyone knows where to go check the pulse. That will be the accurate place to know if a patient is going to get Ross or knock. Next. Now, remember, every time we use ultrasound, I know the data out there. Ultrasound can make you go past those 10 seconds that we're supposed to take to feel a pulse, right? So make sure that when you're using ultrasounds, you do not go beyond those 10 seconds. You can spend 10 seconds during your first pulse check to use the linear probe to help you find a pulse on your patient. Next. So now you've gone through another round of ACLS, CPR is in progress. Maybe you gave some epi. We're going to get into all of that stuff. You've hit your second pulse check. What you should be doing at your second pulse check is using the cardiac probe to look for cardiac activity. This is not a novel concept. I'm sure everyone out here knows and is using this in your current standard of care. But I'm sure a lot of you are going, well, wait a second. Finding the cardiac windows is actually really hard. It takes longer than 10 seconds. So how am I supposed to implement this without spending more than 10 seconds? Next. The way you can do that is find your window during CPR. So once when CPR is in progress and you're at that second pulse check and you want to look for cardiac activity, the person who has the ultrasound, and it should be someone who's more experienced, should be moving around and looking around and trying to find that window so that as soon as the person takes their hands off from doing CPR, you can put that ultrasound probe on and you can look for cardiac activity. Next. So why are we doing this? The reason is that not every patient who is in PEA is actually in PEA. There's this concept called pseudo PEA. Again, I did not make it up. This is out there where basically the patient is so profoundly hypotensive or has such poor cardiac activity that they're not actually in arrest. Their heart's doing something. It's just not doing it very well. And we can't feel a pulse or we're not looking around and noticing that the patient is actually has a heart beating and they're not in arrest. They're just in a profoundly hypotensive, what we call pseudo PEA state. So your job is to figure out, are they in arrest, in a PEA arrest, or are they in this pseudo arrest state and they need different management, which we're going to talk about next. So look at this ultrasound over here. Again, you don't have to be experienced to look at it and see there's not much going on. The ventricles aren't moving. The valves aren't moving. There's a little bit of swirling of blood, but that's probably just because CPR just stopped. So this patient does not have cardiac activity. This is a patient, next, who you would move on and you would do CPR on, right? They are in PEA arrest and they need CPR to help circulate that blood. Next. Now, what about this patient? This is an ultrasound taken from an actual patient who was in a what was thought to be a PEA arrest. So this patient has a heart that's beating, right? Those ventricles are trying to do something, albeit really poorly. You see the valves moving. The ejection fraction is extremely poor. Again, whether you're ultrasound trained or not, you can see that the heart is moving. It's just doing a really poor job. So this patient, next, you wouldn't do CPR on, right? You can be moving against what the heart is actually trying to do. This patient needs different management. They're not actually in PEA. Next. This patient, instead of giving epiboluses, it probably needs an epidrip. Now, I'm gonna say there are, I was not able to find any studies that specifically look at pseudo PEA and giving epinephrine boluses versus epinephrine drip. So I cannot say that the literature 100% supports what I'm saying, but there are a lot of things in medicine that we haven't studied that we can't always necessarily study, or we're just a little bit behind the times. But my point is, and you do what is right for you and what you think is right for your patient. But if your patient is profoundly hypotensive, they need epinephrine drips rather than boluses. And the reason is that we know that while giving epiboluses might increase the rates of ROSC, it doesn't improve neurologic activity. There have been some studies that show that epiboluses are associated with poor neurologic outcomes. So if your patient is hypotensive, give them, it doesn't have to be epi, it could be norepi, but give them a drip rather than going along that PEA arrest management. Next. And again, the literature supports this. There's actually a lot of papers out there in the critical care world and the emergency medicine world that demonstrate this phenomenon of pseudo PEA arrest, where your patient isn't actually dead. They have a heart that's beating. It's just not doing a great job. And we need to support that heart. And as opposed to just blindly doing CPR and giving epi and maybe some calcium and doing pulse checks and kind of getting nowhere. And patients who are in pseudo PEA arrest, so not arrest, they actually have better outcomes. So it's really important to notice this phenomenon that your patient might not actually be in arrest and might just be profoundly hypotensive, the pseudo PEA state that I'm talking about. Next. Again, remember your second pulse check, you do not want to be spending longer than 10 seconds. So you can have someone count out. As the team leader, I'll usually count out or I'll assign someone to do the 10 second countdown, but make sure you're not spending greater than 10 seconds doing this. You can go back to CPR if you think they are still arrested, and then you can try again later, but do not spend longer than 10 seconds. Next. There's other concepts out there when it comes to code management. I'm not going to get into them, like ultrasound guided CPR is a thing that's being talked about. Transesophageal echoes are wonderful. A lot of institutions don't have them. So this is not the lecture for that. These are lectures on their own. But I did want to put a plug out there and say that there are other concepts that can help your patients, but we just don't have the time today to talk about them. Next. So let's say your patient was still in arrest, or maybe not, but we're at a third pulse check. What you should be doing by now that you have all of your systems in place, your team is running like a well-oiled machine, you know where to find accurately look for a pulse, you, let's say, didn't see cardiac activity, your third pulse check, you as a team leader really need to be stopping and thinking and using your brain and going, why did this patient arrest? It's not something that I see people do. And it's mind-boggling because as ER doctors, we're always asking why, what's going on? What's the differential? Well, what's your differential for this patient who's in PEA arrest? Next. Put your Dr. House thinking cap on, right? Think about this as a puzzle, like you would any other patient, and try to see, and you're not always going to be able to figure it out, right? But we have to do better and we have to start thinking, why could my patient be arresting? Next. So how do we do this? So first, just look around, listen to EMS, and start gathering the information that's around you. Next. If it's winter and your patient came in and they're hypothermic, just doing your CPR and epi and maybe some bicarb is not going to cut it. You have to rewarm this patient. If you don't rewarm this patient, you're not going to get ROSC and you're not going to have your patient walk out of the hospital. So move away a little bit from that algorithm and look around in front of you. Next. If this is a trauma patient and they arrest, yes, they need CPR to circulate the little bit of blood that's in them, but more so than all of these other things, they need blood. They need blood products. And we just had an awesome lecture from Dr. Swami about this, right? You have to give them what they need. Trauma patients need blood. Next. If your patient has a history of an opiate addiction disorder, try Narcan, try high doses of Narcan. They might've taken some fentanyl. Maybe this is an overdose, right? So, and the way that you would manage this is not just strictly your ACLS algorithm. So think outside the box and look around and listen and see what's going on with your patients. Next. Some people even come in with medication bans, hospital bans that might give you a clue. Some people I've seen tattoos of their medical problems on them. So look at your patient and they might actually be giving you the answer as to why they've arrested. Next. So you've looked around, you've gathered information from EMS, not terribly helpful, or you didn't get much, might've been a scoop and run. What else can we do? So ask around. Next. And what I mean by that is what I'll do, and we're lucky to be at academic institutions, is I'll send, let's say, an intern, a second year resident, to go do a chart review during this time. I know that sounds crazy, right? But if I have a 45, 50, 55 year old patient who comes in and is in an arrest state that I might be able to get them out of and get them walking out of this hospital, I want to do everything in my power to increase those chances. So look at a chart review. Maybe they were here for severe asthma exacerbation yesterday and they left AMA or CHF, right? There are things that can give you clues and you can help tailor their management. Maybe they were septic and were on antibiotics and discharged, right? Give them fluids, give them pressors, give them antibiotics. These are things that could actually help your patient. Next. So you looked, you listened, you asked around, you're trying to gather as much information as you can. We can go back to using that ultrasound. Next. So besides just looking for cardiac activity, there's things on the ultrasound that we can do that'll help give us clues. So this is D-sign in the right patient setting. This could indicate a large pulmonary embolism. And this is a patient you would consider probably giving TPA for in this case. Next. Let's say you saw this when you did the ultrasound, right? It does not matter how much CPR and epi you give. Your patient is not coming back unless you do a pericardiocentesis, maybe even an ultrasound guided pericardiocentesis. We've had patients from our hospital walk out by doing this procedure. This is a life-saving procedure that your brain and your ultrasound helped you get to the right diagnosis with. Next. And again, all of this is supported in the literature. In pseudo-PEA arrest states, in PEA arrest cases where you're able to find reversible causes, by treating the reversible causes, your patients have better outcomes. They have decreased mortality. They're able to walk out of the hospital with good neurologic function when you can find a diagnosis and treat it. Next. So we did ultrasounds, we looked, we're gathering information. What else can we do, guys? What have I not mentioned? Look up, look at your monitor. Your monitor is going to give you a lot of information and is going to help you figure out what's going on with your patient and what can you do to manage them. Next. Maybe your patient has been here for a while and they were getting hypoxic and they slowly went more and more hypoxic and then they arrested. So yes, you know, CPR, but you know, bagging, maybe intubating, depending why they arrested, they need oxygen. This is what's going to help them have a good neurologic outcome is oxygenation. And that's probably what's going to help them get ROSC. Next. End-tidal CO2, right? We all should be using it. I can't say that we use it every single time, but if your end-tidal CO2 all of a sudden goes from reading 10, 20, jumps up to 40, 50, stop what you're doing. Check a pulse. Your patient has a return of spontaneous circulation, or maybe they came in and their end-tidal CO2 was 40, and you're continuing CPR, 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 maybe you need to stop and think what's going on with the patient because they probably have a blood pressure right now. So the information that you see on your monitor can definitely help you manage these patients. Next. The rhythm that's on the monitor is very important. So why complex tachycardia? You treat accordingly, right? According to ACLS. But if I see something like this, I'm going, wait a second. Maybe this patient's hyperkalemic, or maybe they overdosed on some sort of sodium channel blocker. So what would I do for this patient is I would give them calcium and bicarb. Maybe I'd give them 3 amps of each back to back just to give them as much as I can to see if that changes. And if you see that wide complex narrow in front of you You have your diagnosis, and now you know what's wrong with a patient, and now you can continue to manage them accordingly. Next. And if at any point during your PEA management, your patient, all of a sudden, you think that they are out of PEA and they were actually, or they've always been in this pseudo PEA state, what should you be doing with these patients? We should be doing A-lines, right? This is a patient where an A-line is really important. And even on a busy day, you should take the time to do it. You need to know what's going on with that blood pressure. Is the blood pressure 70 over 50? Has it dropped down to 40 over palp, right? The cuffs aren't always very accurate and they can be all over the place. So these are patients, PEA patients, that most people will advocate to put an A-line in. Next. So I didn't introduce anything that was a novel concept. These are all things that you guys know, but I'm hoping that I was able to put things together a little bit and give you a different thought process and a different approach to how to manage PEA arrest. Next. I'm not saying don't go down the road of ACLS. You have to follow the current guidelines, but I'm saying you could do better than just blindly following a road and doing the same thing over and over again. Next. If you can remember one slide from this lecture, remember this slide. During your first pulse check, you should be using the linear probe to help you accurately find a pulse. During your second pulse check, you want to be looking to see if there's any cardiac activity. During your third pulse check, use your brain, try to figure out what's going on. Next. Again, are they actually dead and did they arrest, or are they in this pseudo PEA state and they're just profoundly hypotensive? Next. First pulse check, linear probe. Next. Second pulse check, cardiac probe. Next. And third pulse, and during your second pulse check, look and see what you see. If there's no movement, then continue on with PEA, but you should still be thinking what's going on with the patient. If you see movement over here, you're probably going to manage these patients differently. And I would advocate to move on to doing pressors as opposed to just blindly doing CPR and epiboluses. Next. And your third pulse check, you want to use your brain and figure out what's going on with the patient. Next. Look around, listen to EMS, try to gather as much information as you can and treat the underlying cause accordingly. Next. Send someone to do a chart review. I've seen this change the outcome of patients by looking at the chart and seeing what they might've been here for in the last day, or they come in here for a lot. Next. Grab that ultrasound. You might be able to see that the patient has a pulmonary embolism, give them TPA or a pericardial fusion. These are the things that are going to change the outcomes more than anything else. Next. And look up, use your monitor. You guys are smart physicians, and the end-tidal CO2, your pulse ox, your blood pressure. These are all things that are going to help you. Next. It's important. We have our patients' lives at stake, and we have the chance to really make a difference in our patients. Next. You're a physician. You're an emergency medicine physician, a healthcare hero. You can do better than just blindly following an algorithm. Next. That's all I have for you guys. Thank you very much. Thanks for sticking with me during the hiccups. Thank you, Joff, for moving through my slides. And that's all I have for you if anyone has any questions.
Fantastic. Such a great way to wrap up.
Really great talk. Thank you so much. I was wondering, when you, so the, after you kind of gone through your third pulse check and you're trying to determine this reversible cause, is there any like formal ultrasound, like a protocol or pathway that you found that is worthwhile to kind of like, you know, systematize that sort of search, or is it more just based on where, you know, where you, you know, looking at the patient in kind of clinical context, kind of looking to, you know, confirm or exclude a suspicion you might have? Or are you doing sort of every time I do this, that, and then the next thing or something like that?
So it's a little bit of both. There are different ultrasound algorithms out there that have been proposed to do during CPR and during codes, but it's challenging, right? Because you only have 10 seconds. So you can't scan through the whole entire body in any systematic fashion in 10 seconds, right? So I think more than, and the other thing I think of, you know, ultrasound looks inside, right? There's a lot of things on the outside that are going to help you. Ultrasound isn't going to help for every diagnosis out there. So I use ultrasound in conjunction with looking at the patient, talking to EMS, trying to do a chart review, calling the family, getting someone here to give us information. And look, I am not saying that you're going to save everyone PEA, right? These patients have horrible outcomes, but you're going to save some people by not just kind of putting your blinders on and following down that ACLS algorithm and thinking outside the box and thinking what could be going on with your patient.
I just saw an article from France suggesting that maybe Norepi is the presser we should use. And it's so perfect for with your talk. I'm thinking what a great way to kind of incorporate that, that maybe when you're seeing what you were describing, that organized cardiac activity and no pressure support, but you're worried about everything you were discussing about the poor association with outcome for epi, maybe norepi is a thing to try, but that is totally, you know, there's some evidence for it, but not a lot. Have you had any experience with it?
I think more than, you know, the norepi versus epi, I feel like it's one of those things in medicine that every 10 years we go, we should be doing epi. No, we're going to go back to norepi. And now we're back onto epi. So I think rather than norepi or epi, and it depends, you know, do you need more beta activity, right? So then epi might be more helpful, but it's the epi boluses, right? We don't give norepi boluses unless we're doing push dose pressors, which we're not talking about that right now. This is because during ACLS, we have been told to give epi boluses because epi boluses have been shown to increase rates of ROS. But they do not improve mortality, and they've been associated with poor neurologic outcomes. So I think knowing that maybe get out of this epibolus thought and epi drips. Again, if the patient's heart is not beating, you do you, follow ACLS. But I'm talking about the ultrasound, the profoundly hypotensive. I'm not giving epiboluses to those patients. I'm giving some sort of drip. If norepi is easier, I'm giving norepi. If we have epi, I'm giving epi. And then again, why is this patient in this profoundly hypotensive state? So the combination of all of those things is supposed to, I mean, the studies have shown that it will actually help your patient outcomes with improved mortality, morbidity, not just artificial things like increased rates of ROSC.
Yeah, you mentioned that there were... Oh, I'm sorry. Just one. So we have a little extra time. So I thought I'll give you an opportunity. You said there were a few things that you didn't have time to go to talk about. You were pointing to TEA and maybe, I don't know, ECMO. I don't know. But if there was one more thing you wanted to tell us super quickly about that, we would love to hear it.
So, the two plugins. Transesophageal echoes are amazing. They should be incorporated in every ED, or so we think right now in terms of code management, but we're not there yet. So, I mean, again, that's a whole other lecture, but as an ultrasound guided CPR is a concept that's being looked at in the academic world where you use your ultrasound to figure out where to put your hands. So depending on the position of the heart and depending on the position of your hands, you could actually be blocking the outflow track every time you press down. So you can, and again, this is a whole other lecture and I am not ultrasound fellowship trained. I will not talk on that, but you can actually see if you're working with the heart or against the heart, and you can move your hands slightly to be having your hands right over the ventricles and pumping the ventricles as opposed to blocking the outflow track. So that's a really great concept. I definitely have tried it myself, and I'm not the person to be giving a lecture on that, but that's something that could also be, if you were curious, incorporated in your code management.
Okay. I think we have come to the end. Thank you so much for
Thank
that
you.
Awesome talk.
What a great talk. Thank you guys. Thanks everyone for joining us today for hopefully our last virtual All NYC EM conference, COVID willing. The plan is to be in real life this fall for number 22. Thank you guys so much. Please, if you have any comments, please don't feel afraid to hesitate to email them to us and let us know or put them in the YouTube chat. We'd love to hear from everyone who is here, what worked and what you'd like to hear more of. And we'll look forward to seeing you all in the fall. And if you're interested in joining the All NYC EM Fellowship Program, applications come out next winter. So keep your eyes open for those. Our next activity will be the Chief Resident Forum for all the chief residents across the city on June 7th of this year. And so if you're a rising chief resident, PGY 2 or 3, depending on your program, look for invitations to that. We'll look forward to seeing you all then.
Yeah, it's a great program. In fact, we were able to get some information to some people from the chief residents chat that got made at the last chief residents forum. One of the programs had trouble with YouTube and we were able to get them Zoom access. So yeah, definitely take part. I mean, that's not the most important thing you get out of the chief residents forum, but it's that chat has been, I think, very helpful for people. Thanks again to everyone who's here still. And yeah, we really look forward to being in person from now on. And I'm going to give you back your afternoon. Thanks.